That song is called Bittersweet Symphony. Those of you who had a lot of free beer yesterday probably experienced that about 6 or 7 this morning. Good morning and welcome back to day 2 of the Ag Credit Conference. Speaking of going out and enjoying a libation, an angry wife complaining to her husband about spending all his free time at the bar. So he's up to here. He says, "You know, fine. Well, you know what? Why don't you come with me?" So, boom, that night she goes out and sets up the bar and says, bartender says, "What do you have?" And lady says, "Geez, I don't know. I'll just have what he's having." So husband orders a couple of Jack Daniels, threw his down, one shot. The wife watched him kind of incredulously, takes a sip of hers and then, you know, spits it out. "Oh, my gosh, that's terrible. How can you drink that stuff?" And the husband says, "Well, there you go. You think I'm out enjoying myself every night." Again, that free beer hit the spot, didn't it, yesterday? Perfect timing. After the conference today, I want to remind you, excuse me, that Dorothy is going to email an electronic survey. North Dakota Bankers Association values your input and will use your feedback to plan next year's conference. So look for that in your email and fill that out and get it back to us. Thank you. We're going to do some door prizes before we get underway here this morning. And you can see the table up front here. We've got a lot of spectacular door prizes. And so Dorothy Lick is going to be in charge. We're doing two bottles of wine to start with. So the first one goes to John Schumacher at American Federal Bank in Grand Forks. John, congratulations. Second bottle of wine goes to Samantha Drader from Merchants Bank in Towner, North Dakota. And our next prize is going to go to Gail Schuyten. Did I do that right? Gail Schuyten from American Federal Bank in Fargo. Gail? Okay. And was that a box of chippers? And another box of chippers goes to Derek Rogers, Bank North in Buffalo. Enjoy those. Another box of chippers goes to Ryan Zerfus of Bremer Bank in Lisbon. Those right there. Another box of chippers goes to Wayne Grenner from Rowlett, State Bank in Rowlett. Okay, put that right there. Okay, well, they're probably finishing up breakfast. Lindsay Marsh, Farmers and Merchants Bank of Tallna, box of chippers there. And Jacob Fanick from First Western Bank and Trust in Minot. Jacob gets a box of chippers as well. All right. Get those out of your way, Scott. And those are our three. You want to do another one? Okay. Well, hey, everybody, good morning, and thank you again for being at the conference today. I'd like to introduce you to a friend of mine. He's so talented. Our first speaker this morning is Scott Steffes. Scotty is president of Steffes Group in Fargo. Scott's here to provide a report on land and machinery. Please welcome Mr. Scott Steffes. Scotty?
Thanks. Appreciate it. Probably want that. I didn't wear my tux, unfortunately. Probably a good thing. So good morning, everybody. First of all, thanks for inviting me. Every time I get a chance to sit in front of people that share clients, I guess that's the message that I have. Your clients are our clients, and those are the people that we work for. Our customers are also your customers, and those are the people we sell to. Does that make any sense? So we divide those. Clients are customer, or clients and customers, clients, people we work for, customers, people we sell to. The beauty of our world is that sometimes they can be one or the other. In other words, they're kind of the same people. And again, they have to come to folks like you to say, "Hey, I want to buy a combine." And they say, "Well, you got any money?" And there you go. So thank you. So I would just like to tell you a couple things about what's going on in today's world. And I'm probably not going to spend a whole lot of time telling you about what's been happening, just simply because you guys get more data and more stuff, I'm sure, available to you internally and externally than probably even we do. And what I would like to do is probably concentrate a little bit more on what we think is The other part about it is that we'll see if I'm right. So 2 years from now, 3 years from now, or whatever else, we've been pretty fortunate in terms of what's going on in the ag world, especially at Steffes, that we've kind of had things kind of happen the way that we thought they were going to happen. It makes us look smart. So anyway, and also I'm going to do a little bit on machinery first and then land at the end. And the machinery is really easy. The land, a lot more complicated, a lot more long term. And again, we'll just kind of do it that way. But before I do that, I know a fair amount of you folks in here, not by name, but by face. And then the other side of it is, but I don't know exactly what you do. So this is just a real quick little poll. So in the banking world that you live in, how many people here bank sugar beet farmers? Anybody? Just a few. Okay, so we can touch a little bit on sugar beets, not much. Anybody bank potatoes? A little bit? Good to be a potato banker right now, I'm telling you. Good to be any kind of banker right now. How about, how many people bank feedlots? Anybody have a feedlot here? A few? Okay. And how about cow-calf operators? A lot of them. Excellent. You guys out in western North Dakota. Perfect. And then the rest of them are, you know, corn and bean farmers. You know, it used to be in North Dakota, we say, well, does anybody raise barley? Does anybody raise millet? Does anybody raise wheat? You know, oats? Remember oats? And now it's corn and beans, even in North Dakota. It's crazy. Just crazy. All the way up to Canadian border and farther. So here's one thing to remember as far as what we're doing. Company, and again, I'm just going to give you a little background. Like I said, some people know us a little bit. Some people don't know us very much. We, my dad started our business in 1960, just real quick. This is an elevator speech. Been in the farm business all my life. I was born and raised in a farm. Ran 250 head of cows and 3,000 acres when I was in high school, and my dad was an auctioneer. And then when my brother Greg, who was a year older than I was, left for college, half the cows left. And when I went for college, the other cows left. No more chore boys. You know how that goes. But I have a background in livestock and in farm machinery and, of course, in the farming side. And as we sit today, we have four permanent facilities, one in West Fargo, North Dakota. I'm from Arthur, born and raised. The other one on the upper right-hand corner is in Mount Pleasant, Iowa. And that's a new facility. Mount Pleasant, Iowa, for those of you who don't know, that's about 80, 70 miles southeast of Cedar Rapids, Iowa, in the far southeast corner of Iowa. And we'll be talking a little bit about Iowa because they always, everything in Iowa happens there first. And the other one up in the upper left is Litchfield, Minnesota. It's about 60 miles west of Minneapolis. And it's right on Highway 12, kind of east of Wilmer. And the other one, let's see, Larchwood, Iowa, which is basically Sioux Falls, South Dakota. So those are our four permanent locations. So we cover the upper Midwest fairly well. And we also have a yard in Mason City, Iowa, that we've been utilizing here the last couple years. And so this is just a quick little elevator speech about, you know, our footprint in terms of what we do. So when I talk about farm machinery values and everything else, it's not just about what happens in your neighborhood. It's more of a bigger macro view. And we're very fortunate that we get a pretty good perspective on just a little bit of everything. I think we did auctions in 9 states last year. So, ladies and gentlemen, there's only 3 things that really affect farm machinery and real estate values in our world. And we always talk about what's going to happen because everybody can see what's happening. And we always go to those 3: interest rates, commodity prices, and crop production. You want to know what's going to happen in the farm world? All you got to do is look to those 3 variables. And everything from 2005 till we are here today has all been directed by that. And there was many, many years in there, probably the most important years from, say, 2008 to 2013, where we were 3 for 3 in pretty much all categories. And that's the reason for the great big run-up that kind of changed in 2013 and corrected itself a little bit and then fired right up again. And that's kind of where we're at today. So, and again, as far as interest rates are concerned, they're the ones that are have the more long-term effect. The ones that changes things instantly and overnight that makes machinery jump 10-15% in a matter of a week is commodity prices. That's the one that has the greatest influence on anything from a market perspective, starting with machinery and then ending in the real estate. And after that, of course, it's crop production. It's amazing to me in today's world, and you guys know this because you get all the statistics, how little effect crop production has on machinery and land markets. And we're sort of kind of experiencing that today, especially out in western North Dakota. Because what's happening around there from a crop production perspective, looking around and what's happening in the marketplace, don't make a whole lot of sense. And you know, again, that you can talk about, there's all these cliches that are out there, the Trump bump, you know, crop insurance, all those other kind of things. So that's kind of where we're at today. Prices, new equipment have really, really changed and come up. I mean, everything is just completely just crazy. Availability of the new, and of course, the availability of the used equipment. People say, well, there's a lot of auctions out there. There really isn't, comparing to what we've experienced in the past. You know, just to give you a point of perspective, when my dad started in the auction business in 1960 in Arthur, North Dakota, in Cass County, North Dakota, there was 323 dairy stops for Cass Clay Creamery. You guys remember that? Yeah. And guess how many dairy stops in Cass County there are today? Zero. Yeah. Who wants to milk cows? Anyway, and that was the transition in the 60s, soil bank, all that kind of stuff. 70s when Earl Butts sold all that wheat to Russia. Pretty soon everybody can give $4 for wheat. I always say there's some significant events that have changed agriculture. It started from horses to locomotives or horses to tractors, and then it went from thrashing machines to combines. And after that, then it went from tractors to four-wheel drives when people started hooking cultivators and getting big power together. And the thing that's changed agriculture to bring it to where we're at today, here's my cliche, Roundup and rock rollers. Those are the two things that changed agriculture. It allowed soybeans to be grown and land that was too hard to keep a sickle on and blah, blah, blah. So anyway, keep that in mind. Let's see. There you go, farm equipment market. There's only, you know, when you go to these things, right, you get all this time and everybody spews things out at you. Here's the message that I'm going to just make sure that no matter what happens or whenever what you remember of what I said is that as we're sitting here today, I mean, we have never been in these precedent times that we're in right now. And in the short term, at least, there's nothing in the marketplace that's going to change that. And if there's one thing that I would remind everybody of is that, you know, this is tall cotton or tall corn or whatever you want to do it. And it's been that way for about the last year and a half or 2 years at least. And even in spite of the drought and in spite of all these other kind of things from a market perspective, and I'm talking about farm machinery and real estate values, not about profit, because that's a little different, because that's more affected the individual. We are in unprecedented times, and we're going to look back on where we're at today in another generation or another 10 years and say, boy, you remember from about 2005 until about 2023, 25, somewhere in there, that was incredible, and what's been happening. And I guess I would tell you that's the number one thing that I'd like to remind you of. It's not always going to be like this. And anybody here start in the 80s? Remember that? I went to auction school in 1980, man, and you know, I would tell you my career started doing farm sales when I was a young kid going out to farm sales. I'd come into a guy's yard and he didn't want to see me one single bit, and he didn't want to see his banker and everything else. And the worst part about it is that he didn't have enough money to buy groceries in a lot of those situations. And then in the 90s, when commodity prices went to heck in a handbasket and all that, we were out in farmers' yard and they were telling us to come out and says, I'm tired of it and I want to get out of here. And guys like you were saying, don't leave, don't leave. We need a borrowing base. And then all of a sudden things turned around in about, what, 04, 03, 05, somewhere in that area. And then, you know, it's been pretty good ever since. The only difference between then and now, probably, I would tell you, is the sneakiness of inflation. The growth that's happened until probably a year or two ago was pretty much organic, or pretty much, you know, we didn't have a lot of inflation. It was more slow, steady rise, that kind of thing. And that's the only difference that we're happening right now. So what's been happening? Just completely, from a point of perspective, the highs of the machinery value. So I can't even read that. What does that say? Used equipment is reaching new highs in 2021. Genius. So it is crazy. I can't tell you, and I'm going to show you a couple slides to present that. And again, guys, it's a supply and demand thing. And you guys already know that as far as you know, your people that are coming in can't buy new machinery. Used equipment keeps going up, blah, 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 that whole thing. And it's going to continue because it's just there, machinery supplies. Here's a perfect example. Look at that. Everybody knows what an RX tractor is. Can you imagine that? You know, when my dad first did his first farm sale in 1960, it was a complete entire farm liquidation, including the dairy cattle and the pigs in Cass County, North Dakota. The sale grossed $5,500. Think about that. And that was, what, 50, 60 years ago? And in today's world, our average farm retirement auction is somewhere around, average is somewhere around $900,000. And you guys know that. You see your farm portfolios all the time. That's how much agriculture's changed. And you're buying $350,000 tractors. But just look what's happened in a short period of time when you compare the hours, smaller tractor, and those are those prices. And it's been drastic, very drastic. Here's another one for you. Everybody, we used to talk about 40-20s all the time, and now we talk about 44-40s as kind of a barometer. And again, $10,000 difference, and I tried to pick out fairly similar examples. Just look at that. I mean, 44-40s brand new in 1980 or whatever else, what were they, maybe 23,000, something like that, and they're still worth that today. And you're going to see that. We're probably going to talk about 8335Rs that used to cost $140,000 when they were bought new, or $160,000, and they're still worth that today, 10 or 15 years from now, because they have good utility. There you go. Crazy. Pretty cool stuff if you're selling. Let's see here. Here's another one for you, combines. Just, again, it has to do with the rise of new and everything else, and It's been kind of one of those things that have changed the market. We used to say that when's the best time to sell a combine? And, you know, back in the day, it was always right before harvest. You know when the best time to sell a combine is right now? Give advice to your borrowers. Right after you're done using it, believe it or not. The fall of the year, Section 179 has completely changed the environment and the dynamics of how people buy farm machinery. And it used to be everybody had a spring farm sale, and in the last 10 years everything's gone to fall. Don't get me wrong, we still do a tremendous amount of activity in the spring from the 15th of February till the 20th of April, but the reality of it is that most of the heavy farm equipment activity takes place in the fall of the year, so we're kind of coming into that event. No mud, fresh machinery, no mice, no dead batteries, no flat tires, and guess what? They get to go to Arizona all winter long and not have to worry about it. And that's kind of that farm retirement mentality. So it's worked out really well. There you go. Just, again, it's stark. When everybody thought that in, you know, would have been the fall or spring of 2019 when COVID hit, that things were going to change and, oh my gosh, this agricultural deal, it just surged, did the opposite. Here's another one, I think. Oh, I've got to go this way. There we go. Sprayers. Used to be, we're selling sprayers for more today than we did 4 years ago, without a doubt. And the bottom of the market after the correction of 2013 occurred in the summer of 16, about. And so some of that new farm machinery that guys bought in 12, 13, 14, it went down 50% in value, and then it came right back up again. There you go. All right, combines, same thing. How many people have red combines? You bet. So here's another little anecdote for you as far as going forward in the future is concerned. I remember my father used to always provide all sorts of wisdom and advice, and he said, go to a farm sale. And it's so funny. You walk around, and guys come from all over the place, and they walk down the yard, and you look at the machinery, and the guy's got all John Deere stuff. And when you pull up to a tractor, you look around, and boy, that guy there looks interested, and he's walking. That guy there looks interested, and boy, looking around, there's people wanting to buy it. Why is it when we go in the front of an international tractor, you pull up to it, and you wonder, I wonder who's going to buy it? And in today's world, it's a lot different. Red and green have really come together in the environments that we live in, and not to say that Deere doesn't control the marketplace as far as quantity is concerned, but it started with the quad-track tractors, and it's kind of come back into the red machines as well on the combine side. Not to the certain extent, but of course in the international harvester world, or Case IH, I just exposed my age, the quad track tractors will outsell a green tractor in today's world, so that's good. And isn't it amazing, those farm families that were diehard green machines, every once in a while you pull in, there'll be a green cultivator in front or behind a red quad track. And congratulations to the Case IH teams. They've really done well in that marketplace. And so don't be afraid of the red machines compared to a resale value perspective. Don't get me wrong, dearness dominates. If I were to give advice from any borrower and say, hey, you know, spend a little, is it worth the extra to spend a little money, especially on a green tractor? And I would wholeheartedly say yes. Yes. And I would say where cases probably had a bit of a diminishing or not quite as much success, it would be in their red mechanical front drive tractors or any of those red machines. The row crop tractors and those kind of things still get dominated by John Deere. So there we go. Why is the marketing acting the way it is? It's not rocket science. There you go. There's your answer. And we'll continue. I will tell you that if you think that machinery markets are strong right now, unless something changes from a black swan perspective, it's only going to get higher. And I have a hard time telling you that. I really do. But there just isn't anything in the marketplace that would indicate that we're going to have any change or any kind of correction from a machinery point of view. So, and again, it's supply chain issues as much as anything else, and also the demand. There you go. We're 18 to 24 months out. So anybody know what Deere has been spending all of their money on investment besides re-rigging and retooling all their factories? They're spending billions. Guess what it is in? Tech. They're buying computer companies and tech companies. Why would Deere be buying computer and tech companies? I have no idea, but that's what they're doing. And they're spending, and just go out and look at their corporate reports. So, you know, the future of agriculture, the number one thing that's probably going to come faster than you think, autonomous tractors. The technology's there. It's just a question of whether or not the market accepts them and willing to pay. And one of the things that's going to accelerate that is the problem that everybody's having. And guess what? Everybody knows what that is, right? Labor. Yeah, can't get anybody to work. And it isn't so much you can't get anybody to work. There's just so much work to do, there isn't enough people to do it. And I think there's a difference between that. And you may or may not agree with that, but I'll show you some slides at the end of the presentation that will kind of more back that up. Everybody says, well, nobody wants to work anymore. And, you know, that may or may not be true. But the reality of it is there's just too much work. And the reason for that is because of growth and all those other things that have been happening here in the country. And I'll show you some slides at the end to verify a little bit of that. What's going to happen right now, though, I would tell you from what we experienced since COVID to right now, it's probably going to be a slower rate of rise because it can't continue being 15, 20, 30% in machinery values and things of that nature. But it's still going to be a rise. It's just going to be slower. And until interest rates rise 2 or 3 points, that's about the only thing that I see that's going to slow it down, or some sort of a economic thing that happens from a politics point of view. So we won't even go there.
A little downside risk. There you go.
So there we go. Leading indicators show that. All right. 2023.
There was a study done from and a statistic from folks like you. 2023 is the time. You guys agree or disagree with that interest rate rise? Anybody say it's not going to rise by 2023? Or interest rates are going to stay the way they are? How many people think that interest rates are going to rise before 2023? A little bit. Yeah. I have a slide, I think I'll show you that from a statistic point of view. That the single greatest thing that's going to change markets, especially on the real estate side, would be the rise in interest rates. Other than that, full steam ahead. So there you go, land markets. And again, good time to hold real estate. Here's one thing that I want to make sure everybody knows and understands from a perspective. I would tell any of your borrowers, and it kind of doesn't serve me very well, but I've always said this, and for 43 years or 42 years of being in the auction business, if somebody says, I want to sell farmland, my immediate first response is never sell farmland, ever, never, 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 ever sell farmland. It's the most valued, the most stable, it's the most constant, and it's certainly not the greatest investment in the world, but it's the foundation of everything that we do in agriculture. And I would tell you that and as far as the future is concerned, you know, there's one thing that's absolutely inevitable, and that is in the future every acre of farmland or pasture land or whatever else is out there will be worth more than it's worth today in the future. Bottom line, no question about it. Well, what the heck? All you gotta do is live through the valleys and figure out a way to pay for it, right? That's the hard part. Funny thing about that. I would tell you that in today's world, there's probably more cash out there than you've ever seen before. And the other side of it is the model is kind of changing a little bit. So, you know, I grew up in the auction business, and the model for all farmers and ranchers and whatever they were, you know, to work their whole entire lives, right, and try to buy some land either from their grandpa or from across the road or their dad or whatever else, figure out a way to get it paid for during their farming career, and of course accumulate as much machinery as they can afford, and then when they're all said and done or when their son has taken over, sell the machinery, pay the tax, and try to buy a house in Arizona or go on a few trips. That's the model. And then live off the rent of the land. That's what everybody does. And to a certain degree, that model hasn't really changed very much, but it is changing a little bit. But I would tell you that I don't see anything in the future that's really going to change that very much either. And the reason that land is so high right now is because the reality of it is there isn't much available. People talk about, you know, lands trading hands and things of that nature, but from a supply perspective and everything else, there's just not a lot going on. Not a lot of auctions and not a lot of land trading hands. And I don't know, that may change in the future, and I'll tell you, show you a couple of reasons why, but there you go. And again, from a land market perspective, you know, there isn't a greater investment, but how do you buy land, pay for machinery, and figure out a way to retire debt? And by the way, there's that little problem about taxes. You know, those are the equations that are out there, and those are the things that make it difficult. So here is something that's completely unbelievable and completely just really hard to understand from a farm kid from Arthur, North Dakota. What's been happening? Cash, cash, cash. It's cash everywhere. It's incredible. And when you go to closing tables on real estate and they're spending $5,500 an acre for land that 3 years ago was worth $3,000, and then you wondered when it was sold at $3,000 why it brought so much, and they pay cash, and they're 75 years old and they're buying farmland, it's just a different environment. And again, and that's not just here in the Dakotas. As a matter of fact, it's probably less here in the Dakotas than it is in the I states and in Iowa, Minnesota, South Dakota, those areas, especially the eastern part of South Dakota. It's cash everywhere. And that's part of the reasons why the market's reacting the way it is. Yeah, farmland, there you go. I used Iowa as an example for two reasons. First reason is North Dakota doesn't have any data like Iowa does. They got a guy at Iowa State, he got a foreign name, and I don't know who he got or how he did it, but he has a pile of money to do all sorts of data gathering and all sorts of statistics, and it's incredible. Iowa farmland is almost becoming like gold in terms of how it's tracked in from a commodity perspective, and way, way more than any other state, including Indiana and Illinois and all those other things. And they use the CSR rating. You guys know what CSR is, right? Corn suitability rating, and it's CSR2 right now. So when we talk about Iowa farmland, we talk about CSR2, and we don't talk about necessarily price per acre. We talk about CSR points. And I remember, 3 years ago when you had a farm and it was a law of diminishing returns. So say, for example, an 80 CSR farm, and it's kind of like CPI, although we don't use it. Anybody use CPI from a real estate perspective here? Think much of it? Not a lot. Anyway, buck 10, you know, that kind of thing, 100, 110 a point on CSR2. And in today's world, CSR2 right now, we're approaching and have and achieved 200. So I think the last real estate auctions that we've done in the last 2 weeks in Iowa, I think our average farmland acre value is somewhere in the neighborhood of probably $16,000 an acre from a crazy number of 12, like, you know, a year and a half ago. And guys that are buying it are usually in the neighbors across the road because the investors aren't really necessarily, you know, they, in Iowa, they're comfortable with a 1.5% cap rate on farmland. And some of that stuff's not even that. And again, it here in North Dakota, if you want to know what real estate values are worth, and from a, just a swag perspective, here's something you can take home with you. And again, it kind of puts a bottom on it, 3. So if you talk about what would be considered, you know, realistic market rents for any particular ground, if you could back that up into a 3% capital rate, gross, you know, don't take taxes out or anything like that, that would be a really good number to start with. And unless it's CRP ground, and CRP ground, unless it's got hunting value, I mean, the guys are paying $3,500 bucks an acre for CRP ground that has a, $50 payment because they want to go shoot pheasants and things of that nature. But, you know, 3 and then CRP, 6. 6 is a good number on CRP ground, and that's kind of a swag as far as what you guys are going to be doing. And, of course, you don't have to pay a certified fee appraiser to tell you that. You just write it down. It works out pretty good. And I don't see anything that's really going to change that. In the farm world, especially in Iowa, there's a reason. And I believe in Iowa, it's 82% of all farmland in Iowa is unencumbered. How many people believe that? It's true. They have the statistic there. What do you think it is in North Dakota? I'm going to guess, what, 50? Anybody believe it's greater than 50? Anybody think that? Anybody think that it's less than 50 probably? Everybody thinks that? There's a lot of, you guys know that because you get to carry the paper. But farm, and the reason for that being is, as much as anything, just guess what, guys? They've been in Iowa since the 1840s. How many, you know, in 1840 in North Dakota, Custer didn't even show up yet. I mean, you'd be ducking. There's not much going on. No railroads, no nothing else. So it's taken that long. There you go. Here's another thing that is heading to North Dakota, and it hasn't happened yet, but 65% or 60% of all Iowa farmland is, they don't farm. There you go. And in North Dakota, it's certainly higher than that, but that's kind of where we're headed. And the reason for that being is age of the population and everything else. That's what we can expect. We're a generation behind up here in North Dakota. So if you've got young people in the farming world in North Dakota and they have good balance sheets and the ability and the wherewithal, they have incredible opportunities coming forward to them in the future if they mind their P's and Q's and keep their debt structure so that it's manageable. Never been a greater opportunity in agriculture for a young person, in my personal opinion. And the reason for that being is because a lot of exiting is gonna happen. Okay, dilution. Greatest problem that we see in real estate today. Everybody know what I'm talking about? So here's an example. I was at a closing in Iowa on 60-acre parcel of ground. By the way, in our Iowa, 60 acres isn't 60 acres. It's not the, you know, the southwest half of the south half of the southwest quarter. It's 60.24 acres. Everything in Illinois, Iowa, is all to the tenth decimal, surveyed, pinned, and sold by the acre. Well, if you're going to get $16,000 for it, you leave an acre lay. It's a big number, or you leave two. But when I went to that closing table, there were 16 people sitting across the table from us that all owned that 60-acre piece because they were the grandchildren and the great-grandchildren of the people that started it or people that farmed it or bought it. And we don't have that quite yet here in North Dakota, but we have grandchildren. And the thing that's really changed in the real estate world is, you know, and everybody here in the room that was involved in farming and farmland, what did your grandparents and your parents ever say? Don't ever sell land, right? And then all of a sudden, you know, I'm gonna work hard and I'm gonna pay for all this land and, you know, mom and I are gonna do our estate and, by the way, we're gonna figure out a way to give it to you kids or pass it on to you. And what's happening and what's being discovered, and it's coming this way, so they don't have the ties to agriculture anymore. So in the 80s in Iowa, when everybody got in trouble and everything else and, you know, they managed to save the family farm, it meant values, I would say not likely, not likely at all, unless Putin does something silly or something happens with China or whatever else. There's just nothing out there. So if you order, and again, on the machinery side, the same thing, anything. So as far as planning retirements and doing all those other kind of things, everybody always asks, when's the best time to have an auction? I'm going to revert back to my father's favorite saying, and guess what that is? When you're ready. There really isn't a bad time right now. Fall, spring, whatever. The other thing that's changing from an agricultural perspective, because of the values of the farmland and the value of the equipment and things like that, you can't afford to leave a piece of machinery sit. We used to do that all the time, or we'd have a couple tractors that get 50 hours a year on them or whatever else. And the farmers are starting to recognize and realize and understand, just like the contractors did 20 years ago. They're buying and selling and moving machinery around based on its use. And I would tell you that there's getting to be more and more of that going on. And the internet has really changed everything for that to happen. The only time that we used to do auctions in the 80s and the 90s is when you either died or you retired from farming, or somebody like you called my dad up and said, hey, you gotta go out and see Joe or whatever it may be. And in today's world with the internet, they're using those tools and buying and selling and moving machinery around. And again, anybody that has idle assets that are sitting out there, and from a recommendation point of view, I can only tell you that, you know, get rid of it and move on and use those cash to other ways. In today's world, I can tell you a statistic as far as what we're doing and everything else. I think we did something like 500 auctions last year, or 600 auctions. This year we'll probably do about 700, and about, oh, I'm going to say 250 of those would be real estate auctions. The rest of them would be machinery and estates and things of that nature. And I would tell you that 50% of what we're doing right now is internet only. In other words, there's never an auctioneer or anything of that nature. And on our live auction events, I would tell you that 50% of the items, especially the big machinery items, get sold to internet bidders. Here's a funny story. I was selling the 9230 Case IH combines with the big tracks in the front? Did I get the model right? Yeah, 9230. And it brought something like $297,000 or some number like that. And it was at a farm retirement auction sale. And so I was at the auction. I was walking back up to our hauler trailer. And the neighbor comes in. I said, hey, Brian, what are you doing? I haven't seen you at the auction sale. You were, you know, I was changing shovels on my field cultivator. And I go, oh, well, what are you doing here? He says, well, I bought the combine. And I said, wait a minute, that combine went to an internet bidder. And he goes, yeah, that was me. I was changing cultivator shovels, and I didn't want to come over here. And he was 5 miles away, and he was using the internet to buy a combine. He wasted $1,000. That's where buyer premium is. But to him, it wasn't. That wasn't his time and energy was so much more important. And I thought that really struck me. People are using the internet, and they're using it as a convenience tool. 70% of our activity on our internet is this right here. 70%. Not that over there. Everybody's mobile. And it's probably going to be even more than that. And I'll show you a couple things that I can leave you with before we're finished here. But again, internet has changed everything. And then from a quantity and a market perspective, and that's wonderful because everybody has knowledge nowadays. Through the 1980s, when people sold farm machinery, I'm going to tell you that 50% of the farm machinery that we sold through the 80s went to jockeys. Everybody know what a jockey is? Used equipment dealer. And those folks and those families have really, really been, what would you say? They've been thinned out just like auctioneers have been. Because now everybody knows everything. When you went to an auction sale, a jockey would come from Aberdeen, South Dakota to buy a truck in Hallock, Minnesota, because Hallock, Minnesota guys were buying end dump trailers to haul their sugar beets with, and they don't need gas twin screws anymore. But Aberdeen, they were happy to have a twin screw because they all were too cheap and they bought tags. And so they would, you know, buy it. Jockey came up and he'd buy it and he'd move it down. And nowadays, there's another phrase that we use. Guess what that is? Death of distance. Death of distance. People don't think anything of traveling. Well, for example, we sold a big bud tractor at that Mullins auction in eastern Montana. was at Culberson, Montana, and it brought $135,000, and that gentleman had owned it for 30 years. I don't remember. It was just, who buys a big bud for $135,000? I think our pre-sale estimate was something like $72,000. And he was from Arkansas. Yeah. Isn't that crazy? Happens all the time. All the time. When in the 80s, when I first started, we'd do a farm auction, and basically you'd go out and get the list, and you'd use the old blueprint paper. Remember when you had to press hard real, and then you'd go copies because it was too cheap to buy a copy machine? And you take it to the printer, and you take it to the Fargo Farm Green section, and the Farm and Ranch Guide, and the Ag Week magazine, and that was it. That's how you advertised. In today's world, everything is social media. Everything. It's changed dramatically. 60% of the equipment that we used to sell went to people that were on our mailing list. And now, 75% of all that we sell goes to people that are registered users. Isn't that cool? Changed. Very much so. And I'm sure you're going to be hearing more of that, because we're not the only auction company out there. There's a bunch of us. And again, I just don't think that from a market perspective, I promise you in 10 or I keep telling our young guys right now, I says, take it in, folks, because this is really good times. And it's really going to be good for a little while yet until something changes. This kind of goes back to what I was telling you earlier about, you know, it's not necessarily people don't want to work, is that there's just too much work. But it also kind of goes in line with what I was telling about as far as maybe a slower growth rate. And you can kind of see a little bit of that right now after the stimulus. This is a slide I got from ITR Economics, which is, does anybody subscribe to RTR Economics except for me? Great little reporting deal. It's like $30 a month, and they take all the census information and they parse it down to you, and very valuable. But that kind of shows you that whole thing about the slower growth. It's still way above the growth line, but it's slowing, and that's probably healthy, I think. And there we go, increasingly risk-laden. And that's the other subject that we're talking about. Here's another reason why everybody's buying farmland. If I had cash, and there's a lot of cash out there, what would I do with my money? What would I do with my money? And so many of those folks are answering that question, and they're trying to buy farmland. And, you know, I honestly believe that United States farmland should be considered as valuable or more valuable than gold, because it's a finite asset, and, you know, it's hard to determine the value. In today's world, right now, people value land more than money. They don't value money as much as they do land. And I think that's really unique and interesting. One of the things that could potentially change that, the single most important, greatest risk factor to what's going to happen in the real estate world, rising interest rates. And the reason for that being is that we have so many people that have cash, and they don't know, what am I going to do with my money? And when interest rates rise, that means CDs are going to rise, bonds are going to rise, all those fixed income things that are good, safe, sound investment, and that 1% rate of return with the idea of appreciation from farmland isn't going to be nearly as attractive as, hey, I can get 3% on a six-month CD, or I can, you know, do those things. And I tell you, that's kind of what's happening, or what I see would be happening and looking forward to from a leading indicator point of view. And again, I don't see any of that occurring until at least 2023, somewhere in that area. Not going to happen. But, you know, and where we're halfway through October right now, and that's always the turning event, but there's some things from a stock market perspective that would kind of tell you to indicate that I don't think it can continue that widening river mentality that's been occurring for a while. And to me, that's a slide that potentially, not to say that it's gloom and doom or anything of that nature, but something has to change because it can't continue on the trend that it's in right now. So I thought that was interesting. You guys like that? I'm not a stock market guy, but anyway. Here's something that we just, and this is not a solicitation or anything, because guess what? It's free. So technology is everything. Anybody here ever subscribe to our Steffes Price Guide? price guide, we'd poke you for $25 for them for the last 30 years and put them in your desk drawer and everything else. Well, guess what? Costs so much to print those things, we're going to do it online. And the other side of it is we're not going to charge for it. So we introduced our Steffes Price Guide app on coincidentally Monday, or what day is it today? Thursday. Yeah, Monday or Friday. I can't remember which. So all you got to do is go to your app store. Anybody that's in the farm world, go to your app store, Google or Apple store or whatever else, and just see if you can, see if I'm right. Steffes Price Guide, put that in the, put you in a deal. So we've always had that data, and we've been using it internally, but we put 3 years of price on that, and you guys can use it any way you want, and it's really, really helpful. Also for your, and tell your farmer friends too, it's free. We don't profit from our price guides by any stretch of the imagination. And the one thing that was the genesis of the price guide was, is that, remember what I was telling you about the jockeys? And I couldn't ever understand why a farmer would come to a farm sale, watch an equipment dealer buy a tractor, and the next day go to the equipment dealer and buy it from him when he was standing at the auction sale and he wouldn't bid on it. I mean, that used to happen all the time. You want to know why? He didn't know as much as the jockey did, or he was afraid, because he didn't know what the markets were, and he didn't want to pay too much. And that's really, really changed. And the reason for that being is part of the thing from the price guide perspective. You know, what's this stuff worth? You know, what's it bringing? Those kind of things. And that's where the price guides become really, really helpful for us. We use it every day, absolutely every day. And for you guys, hey, I want to buy a combine, or hey, I should sell my combine. Well, it's only worth $100,000. Well, geez, Steph has just sold four of them in the last 6 months, and they averaged 160. What do you mean? You should sell it. If I can get on, you know, that kind of thing. Knowledge is power, folks. Everybody knows that. So there you go. I would tell you, as far as what to look for in the future, I saw so many hands up in the livestock world. You guys that bank livestock guys and the folks that in the cattle business, just shake my head in terms of how they continue to survive and thrive and prosper. If you have livestock guys, you had asked me this question, Scott, if I were in the livestock business and I had livestock equipment, gates, feed bunks, calf creep feeders, head gates, squeeze chutes, whatever it may be, you know, I want to buy, or I need some of that stuff, you know what my advice would be? Buy new. It is absolutely amazing. I don't think there's a better collateral asset. I'm not saying profit or loss or anything like that. But you livestock guys, there is no better collateral asset in the agricultural world than livestock equipment. And you go out there and sell 40-year-old concrete feed bunks that have been sitting for 20 years because he sold the cattle. And he said, I bought those in 1973, and I paid $80 a piece for them, and they've been sitting for 20 years, and we sell them for $250 a bunk. And because new, they're 400. It's just incredible. So anybody that wants to, in the livestock business, and they say, hey, I want to go buy some livestock equipment. Well, geez, you know, can you afford it? Well, that's the hard part. But from an asset point of view, boy, oh boy, it's just, and again, from an advice perspective, manure spreaders, tractors, the loader tractors, skid steers, all those kind of things, just as rock solid of a collateral asset as you could ever buy. The things that are the most difficult, our specialty items and combines. And the problem with combines is they're always out of season. Because in North Dakota, most people use combines for 10 days to 2 weeks, pretty much. It's about, you know, from a harvest point of view. They have to because they can't get the crop up otherwise. It's completely different. It's amazing to me the differences in the geography that I've really learned over the years. Everybody asks me, why is Iowa farmland so much more expensive than North Dakota or Minnesota? Well, first of all, their taxes are lower. In eastern Nebraska, real estate taxes on irrigated corn ground are $100 an acre, taxes. In southern Minnesota, they're $50 to $75. In Iowa, $15,000 an acre farmland is probably taxed at about $17, something like that, because they whack the credapers out of warehouses and commercial real estate. That's where they get their revenue from. North Dakota is pretty good that way. But the reason that Iowa farmland, besides, you know, crops and everything else, they get more for their commodities. Bottom line, get more for their commodities. And so when you can, when there's a 25% market difference just for basis spreads, think about 25% in a farm operation and what it would do to your bottom line. And that's as much as anything. Yeah, sure, they can grow 200 bushel corn a lot easier than, you know, you can in the Red River Valley or wherever else, even in the central part. But the reality of it is one of the reasons that the farmland is so much more value is because you get more for their crops. The other thing that's absolutely amazing to me, and you guys are all farm folks too, when you go in North Dakota and Minnesota and whatever else. In Iowa, most of those guys, they farm the family farm, and they got a job in town, and they come out, I might go make a few rounds this afternoon at 5, but my kid's got a basketball game, I might wait till tomorrow. It's amazing, other than, and because they can afford it. The climate is so much easier for them. They can start putting fertilizer on in February if they want, if they're ambitious to, and again, it's just different. And I think that's the, what would you say, the learning experience here. Don't make decisions on what you see around you. Don't make decisions of what you see around you. Look to the bigger picture. That's a better thing. That's the last thing I'm going to leave you. Anybody got any questions? So, drought. I was in Sydney last Thursday, and they still haven't gotten rain out there. Anybody getting any rain? And we're in Watford City, just really, really dry. Hopefully that'll continue. We're getting rain in southern Minnesota. They were dry as well. Thank goodness for crop insurance. That's been very, very helpful. Takes the bottoms out. So you guys enjoy your morning. Are you quitting at noon? Sounds like a good plan. So thanks for having me. If you got any questions, don't be afraid to reach out. And like I said, check out our website and use the app. It's really cool. Play around with it. And if you have a problem with it or if you think of something that would be really cool for us to add, tell me. Thanks.
Mr. Tuxedo guy.
Thanks very much, Scott Steffes. Your knowledge and information, absolutely insightful. Thank you very much. We're going to take a 10-minute break before we move to our three breakout sessions, but before everybody gets up and flies, refills her coffee, runs to the bathroom, just a couple of notes. Lisa from the North Dakota Bankers Association office is here and wants to take pictures of you and your groups if you'd like. Bankers Association uses those for their newsletter and more. So right in the back of the room, right? Right over here? Over on this side. If you'd like, we'd love you to stand for a photo right when we're done, while we take this break. And here's what's coming up next. We've got breakout sessions with NDSU experts. Frayne Olson from Ag Marketing will be right here on the main stage in about 10 minutes. Sean Brotherson is going to talk about farm stress right next door. And Dave Ripplinger is going to talk about carbon and conservation in the courtyard. Right across there. So get your picture taken, take a break. We'll do about 10 minutes worth, and then we'll start those breakout sessions. Thank you, everybody.
contact information. I recognize quite a few familiar faces in the room. There's also some new faces, which is great. So my task today is to try and give you a market update on kind of what's happening in the grain markets. I want this to really be more of a conversation than a lecture. I do enough lecturing, I hate it. I'd rather have a conversation. I have a lot of information here. Some of it we're gonna buzz through pretty quickly. Some of it we're gonna spend a little more time focusing on it. If you have anything throughout the presentation that you're wondering about or wanna raise questions, please holler out, we'll stop, we'll take a break and try and get those answered. So, because the main point again is to try and help you understand what's happening. Now, one of the things I'm gonna try and focus on today specifically is what are the key things that the futures market in particular, what are some of the market traders and analysts really looking at right now today? Because we're kind of in this funny time zone where we're transitioning from looking at what's happening in the US and US production, how many bushels we're gonna have available within the system, to, okay, how do we use those bushels up? Okay, how quickly are you gonna be able to get rid of the supplies that we have available? So here's my contact information. If you guys think of something on the drive home or wanna visit about something specifically privately, that's fine, give me a holler and I'll do my best to answer those questions. All right, now you guys are probably tired of seeing the drought monitor map. I know I am. It's up here in the Northern Plains. This is not anything new. Okay, what I do want you to notice is some of the spread that's occurred over the last several months. And in particular, in that region, parts of Kansas and Oklahoma and Texas. All right, here's trivia. Why is Kansas, Oklahoma, and Texas important for the grain markets up here? What's going on right now in that region? Planting winter wheat. Okay. Now, winter wheat acres, we're still waiting to hear. We won't know the official numbers until sometime in January. The expectation is that winter wheat acres will probably be stable. I don't know that they'll increase a lot just because of the relative price relationships right now. Okay, now a lot of the guys in that region for the cattle perspective, they also put in winter wheat, they let it come up, they start greening up, they use it as kind of a supplemental pasture to try and background or put some additional weight on. They stock our cattle and then they bring them back into the feedlots for finishing. Okay, now that works really well when you got good soil moisture and you got lots of rains. So I'm not saying that they're gonna, farmers in Kansas and Oklahoma and Texas are gonna change their planting plans because of this, but it is something we need to be watching because we may not quite get the emergence and the establishment that we would normally expect. Okay, so the wheat market is kind of keeping an eye on this. They're not panicking yet, they're not concerned yet, but they are keeping an eye on it. The big debate we've had all summer is what about yield and yield potential? Now, I ran across this a couple months ago. It's actually, I think, kind of cool. A lot of times you've seen these, and I've used them myself in some of my presentations, these NDVI index, the vegetative index. They take a satellite snapshot of how kind of green and healthy is the crop. They use that as a proxy for yield and yield potential. There's actually some pretty sophisticated modeling where they tried to take this satellite imagery and trying to forecast and predict yields. Well, this is put out by the same group of people that put together the drought monitor maps. So the one that I just showed you, this one. They're also collecting those, and what they're doing is they're accumulating it. So they're taking the greenness this week, adding it to the greenness next week, and so on and so on and so on throughout the growing season. So you get more of a snap, not just a snapshot of what's happening today, but what has happened to the growth and the health of the crop throughout the growing season. Okay, now obviously the red means it's below average and they're using a 20-year time period as an average. The blues and the greens are above average. So let's filter this out, because this is pasture land, it's forest land, this is everything that has green. If you focus on just cropland, what do you see? Now these are just cropland acres. No big surprise, North Dakota, we've been in a drought for all summer long. This is not a big shock to the marketplace. What else do you see? That's baked in. I mean, the problems we had in North Dakota were baked in March, April. What might put a shock to the marketplace? I know this has been a long conference. What are we debating right now? What are the things we're debating right now and having arguments over in the marketplace? Not whether the Vikings are going to win or not. It's yields, right? It's corn yields, it's soybean yields. So if you look at that big blob in the middle of Iowa, there's been a lot of focus on that red blob in the middle of Iowa saying, hey, what does that really mean for corn and soybean yields? Because Iowa and Illinois are by far number one, number two in bushels produced for corn and beans. Now, they trade back and forth on who's number one and number two and which crop it is. Usually, Iowa wins in corn and Illinois wins in soybeans. And also, I want to focus on Minnesota. That's been kind of the developing story, is what's happening in southern Minnesota. Coming out of the eastern Corn Belt, Illinois, Indiana, Ohio, Missouri, Kentucky. Will those be enough to offset the losses we saw in the western Corn Belt? North Dakota, South Dakota, Minnesota, Nebraska. Now, recognizing Nebraska has a lot of irrigated land. So the current thought process is, when you look nationally, yes, there's going to be enough bushels around. Nationally. Remember this map when I come back towards the end. I'm going to talk about what's happening today in the basis, the local cash markets. Has anybody watched what's happening in the local basis levels, that spread between futures and cash? What normally do we see for corn and soybean basis levels at harvest in North Dakota? What's a typical number? Dollar under for soybeans. How about $1.10 under for soybeans? How about for corn? Yep, 70, 75, sometimes 80 when you get out west. What are they today? Minus 40 on soybeans, minus 20 on corn. We have a better corn basis in North Dakota than they do in Illinois right now. Spot market corn basis in Illinois is about a minus 50. We're at about a minus 20 or 25. Why is that happening? There's actually a series of reasons. Part of it is that. Local basis reflects local supply-demand conditions. What's local supply going to be in North Dakota for corn and beans? Pretty tight. How about for Illinois? Then you add in some shipping problems out of the Gulf of Mexico in the export market, and suddenly you can get a minus 50 basis in Illinois, and they're screaming. There's some really pissed off farmers in Illinois right now. Okay, enough of that. I better keep going or I'll never get done. I throw this up here, and again, if you want a copy of this presentation, I'd be happy to share it. This is the most recent supply-demand information. We're gonna get an update on Tuesday next week. There's not expected to be any major shocks, but we will get an update. So now the mentality of the marketplace right now is we're refining our expectations. We kind of know where we're at, and we're narrowing that range of kind of what we think is going to happen. So I don't see a lot of shock value. A lot of times in the October report, we do get some shock value. We get some movement in the markets in October because we have enough yield reports that we're feeling better about the yield expectations. This year, I think it's going to be kind of quiet because harvest started early, and we kind of know what we've got. So a couple numbers, all right? Right now, just to give you an idea, and I can't quite see all of these because I recently had eye surgery, so I'm still learning to focus. The current trade estimates for the October numbers are small decrease in corn production. Again, we're kind of tweaking and refining. The corn yield, the national average corn yield. So this is the part that kind of frustrates me. I hear some market analysts, I won't say who, some of them are national, a couple of them are local. that bash USDA and say, oh, you know, USDA, even with all the drought, they're forecasting another record corn yield or a record soybean yield. Yeah, that's true if you look back, but if you don't, you have to adjust for the trend line yield. So the red line that bounces around is the actual yield that we got in the US. The blue line is the trend line. So think about trend line as an average that's been adjusted for better farming practices. It's better technology when it comes to the seed, planting and harvesting. Just the whole science of agriculture is getting better. We're basically looking at an average corn crop this year, maybe just a smidge under average from a yield standpoint. This is going to be, if USDA is right, and I think they're very close, this is going to be the second largest corn crop in history. When you count bushels, yield per bushel is about average. We increased our plantings. So here's the weird thing. North Dakota is going to produce more corn bushels this year than they did last year. The state of North Dakota will produce more corn this year than they did last year, total bushels. Why? Prevented plant. Last year we had a hard prevent plant, especially in those heavy corn producing regions. And what happened this spring? We got it all planted. So yeah, our yield stinks, but our acreage is up, and the acres more than compensated for the drop in yield. Let's talk about use. Again, we're in this funny zone right now between arguing over how many bushels versus how quickly you're going to use it up. I'm going to go through this pretty quickly because I got to speed up or I'll never get none. Blue line on top is for feed. USDA right now is kind of looking at a flat line or slight decrease in feed. I don't know. That I think they'll be close. More of that will probably be residual, which is kind of spoilage and wastage. The red line is ethanol. There's still some questions about ethanol consumption, and it's much more about the miles driven and the recovery of our economy than it is about ethanol prices. Profitability has returned to the ethanol industry. It's not really fantastic, but at least they're making some bottom line black instead of red. The issue right now is, are we driving enough miles to be able to chew up some of that ethanol production? Now, we're recovering again, coming out of this recession, or coming out of the COVID issues, and hopefully we'll be driving a little bit more. The one that people have their most eyes on, even though it's a smaller number, is it's harder to predict, is the exports. And the reason, last year we had record export pace. Why did we have record exports in corn? I'm trying to quiz you on why this is happening, so when you see something come up in the news, you can adjust what I'm saying today to compensate. The trade deal. Okay, what did the trade deal do to help corn exports? It was China, right? It was not illegal to buy U.S. corn anymore. And they came in with a vengeance and bought a lot of U.S. corn. Now, part of that was to refill some inventories. Part of it was for immediate use. Current USDA forecast, I guess I personally tend to agree with that, is I think we'll have a slight reduction in our total corn exports. Number one is, corn exports is, last year was China. China was our number one corn customer last year. Normally it's been Mexico. Last year was number two. They chewed up more corn than they did the year before. Okay, so our total corn exports to Mexico, which historically has been our number one country, got surpassed by China. Okay, I don't think China's gonna be as aggressive as they were before, but they are gonna buy US corn. So our ending stocks are forecast based on what the trade is expecting to see next Tuesday, a slight tightening of their corn inventories. So what we're trying to forecast here is how much grain are we going to have left in the bin before harvest of next year. So September next year, how much grain do we think we'll have left? What I like to do is focus on those blue bars on the bottom, the stocks to use ratio. We take our ending stocks divided by total use. What's our margin for error in case we have a problem? 10% seems to be in the markets, tend to be kind of that tipping point. If we have more than 10% carryover stocks in corn, the corn market feels comfortable. See, we can take a hit and not have too much trouble. We're going to have some reserves. So we tend to see prices lower and more stable. If it gets under 10% carryover, we tend to see really high prices with a lot of volatility. Because any new piece of news, it's, well, what's that going to do to our bottom line? And there's a lot of jittery, you know, they're very jittery and nervous. We're right at that tipping point. So from here forward, it's going to be a conflict over, do we have enough or is there too much? I want to give you some long-term perspective. And I know I was hoping this would show up a little bit bigger on the charts. I pulled this morning. This is as of about, a little over an hour ago. So this is nearby futures, so we're reflecting now today in December corn futures. Where are we today relative to where we were back in 2012, 2013, and 2008, the last time we saw these big spikes? Those blue and red lines that I put in, those are kind of support and resistance levels that I drew in. Where are we at today? I get this question all the time. Have we seen the high-end corn yet? What do you think? Yep. I think corn, you know, there's this saying, small crops have big tails, or short crops have long tails, right? I think there's a very, very good chance we're going to see corn kind of slowly drift lower, at least old crop corn, as we move into the winter months. We'll wait to see. But I just want to give you some perspective on 2011, 2012, 2013, which is kind of in the middle of the graph. Where are we today relative to there? Now, I didn't adjust for inflation and all that kind of stuff. This is just absolute numbers. One more thing. We need to sell a lot of our grain internationally. On the margin, we still need to sell a lot of corn internationally. Okay. Where do you see the... Now, this is corn loaded onto a vessel delivered to North Asia. North Asia would include China, Korea, and Japan. This is the forward bid. So I get through some of the stuff we have at NDSU, I get the chance to look at the forward bid. So this would be like the elevator, saying if you want, instead of selling today, if you want to sell 2 months from now or 3 months from now, what would you offer, right? Same thing goes on in the international market. So if I'm an international buyer for corn, and I'm looking for a January, February delivery period, who am I going to buy from and where's that corn going to come from? So I'm a buyer now. You got to think like a buyer, not a seller. Where are you going to buy corn from? So I got to, again, my eyes got to focus.
So USPNW is the blue. US Gulf is the green. The red is Brazil.
What do you think is going to happen, guys? We have an advantage out of PNW shipping to North Asia, mainly because of ocean freight. I'll talk about that at the end, for a few months. By the time the Safrina crop, that winter crop of corn, comes out of Brazil, we're going to have a tough time being competitive if they have a crop. There is an if with that because they haven't even planted it yet. But this is the numbers that the market is currently looking at and thinking about. Okay? The shift to soybeans. Now you get the rhythm of what I'm doing. We're going to go a little faster. This is the supply demand for soybeans. Two of the numbers that we're focused on for the report on Tuesday would be the total yields, the yield per acre and the total bushels. They're expected to be increased a little bit. The yield reports are getting out of beans are a little bit stronger than we first thought. We're slightly above average yields, but not fantastic, right? This is a good year, not a great year. And let's look at the red line versus the blue line. How about consumption? Now, there's a lot of things going on in the world of soybean crushing right now. And if you want to talk about it, I'd be happy to do that. But again, I want to stay on time. The crush demand is forecasted, expected to continue to grow very steadily for the next several years. Okay, some of that is exports for soybean meal, U.S. soybean meal. Some of it, and a lot of it, is the driving force behind renewable diesel, which Dave Ripplinger is talking about in the other room over here. And on a footnote, on a sidebar, renewable diesel is not the same as biodiesel. Biodiesel, you're taking soybean oil, you're splash blending it with diesel fuel just like you do with ethanol. Renewable diesel, you're making diesel fuel out of soybean oil. Renewable diesel is chemically identical to the diesel fuel that comes out of a refinery. It's just your feedstock going in is soybean oil, not crude oil. And the carbon credits, the carbon footprint for renewable diesel is a fraction of what it is for crude oil diesel. And right now in California, they're buying renewable diesel. The Marathon plant out in Dickinson is doing renewable diesel. It's only this second plant in the U.S. that's doing that. All of it is going to California. I did the math backwards. It would take every drop of soybean oil in the U.S. to produce enough renewable diesel to supply California. This is a big deal. The reason ADM put their plant in Jamestown, they already have a contract to sell all of their soybean oil to the Marathon plant in Dickinson. That was the tipping point that ADM said, yes, we're going to do this. That's a big deal, guys, and it's coming. But it's going to take a while because we've got to build our infrastructure. Short-term exports are going to be the big thing. China's, again, having some issues with their livestock sector, which I'll talk about at the end. We are expecting soybean exports to China to drop a little bit. Not dramatically, not like we saw in the trade war days. All right, what about ending stocks? This is the one that I'm watching on soybeans. The ending stocks number have been all summer long has been paper thin. I mean, we are at supply chain levels. USDA was forecasting like pipeline levels all summer long, and now they gave us a little bit of breathing room. At least that's the expectation. What do you think that's going to do to soybean prices? We went from, oh my God, we might run out. We got to ration really, really hard to, I think we did it. Soybean is still going to be very volatile based on South America because we're expecting. Right now, the mentality of the market is we're going to have a big crop coming out of South America. If that expectation changes, soybean will take off again. Canola prices, oh my God, if you look at new crop canola prices, have your guys book them. I mean, I don't know what the heck they're waiting for. Sunflower too, I saw some sunflower contracts come out that looked awful good for 2022. So we're looking at some exceptionally tight, nearly record tight ending stocks, but that number in the red is gonna go up a little bit. We're gonna give ourselves a little more breathing room because of these higher yields. Where are we for pricing? Again, this is comparing today's prices this morning, which is in the blue, compared to where we have been historically. Has the peak of the soybean market in? Is it in? It is, unless there's a major problem in South America. Now, that's old crop. New crop, we're still negotiating on. All right, this is one thing you guys got to understand. Our export window for soybeans in the global market is about 4 to 5 months long. These are the current export bids to North Asia, think China, for the next several months. When does the blue line cross the others? Because the other ones are Argentina and Brazil. How much longer will our export window last? When do those lines cross? Yep. About January. By the time we get into February, we're starting to lose our market share. So rephrase that. If you have to have soybeans delivered to China by January, when do you need to buy those beans? Pretty soon. Next couple months. What's your window for selling soybeans? Without gambling like roulette gambling where you go to Las Vegas. Couple more months. Okay. Wheat, man, wheat. Been pulling my hair out of wheat for wheat, you know, with wheat for the last 5 years. Our wheat numbers are finally coming down a bit, mainly because drought helped take some inventories out. We did get some surprises out of the small grains report, which is kind of the official production numbers for wheat. Nothing too dramatic, but I actually took winter wheat production down a bit more than people expected, which was positive for the wheat markets. How do we use up wheat? Again, blue line is domestic milling, the red line is exports. If you guys had to forecast the amount of wheat going into domestic milling, could you do that? That's the blue line. So guys, it's been pretty flat for a long time. I mean, this is like a 30-year time frame. So what puts the volatility into the wheat market? Exports. Okay. Our ending stocks, the ending stocks of wheat now are finally coming down. Graphically, this is what it looks like. We've come off some really big years. We're looking at a 10% carryover stocks in corn is the tipping point. We're at 3.5 to 4% on soybeans. We were at 45% for wheat. Now, we normally carry more wheat. Our wheat inventories, you know, typical is between 30 and 35%. We're finally now getting below that 30% number. Now, we're not short of wheat. Spring wheat we are, but not wheat. So we got to worry about substitution. How much of a premium can spring wheat hold over winter wheat? That's the question I'm trying to answer. If we look at spring wheat stocks, and I do think these numbers will tighten up. We've got the official, again, production numbers coming out of USDA now, so these, I think, will tighten up some more. The Canadians are having a shorter crop than I think a lot of people expected. StatCan was kind of overshooting. We're now getting some provincial reports on yields that are quite a bit lower, actually, than what Statistics Canada was forecasting. So I think the Canadian crop for both spring wheat and durum is going to be a lot tighter than they first expected, which is also one of the reasons we're seeing some support coming in the spring wheat markets. Let's look at spring wheat specifically. Again, how much do we use domestically versus export internationally? Notice how our exports of spring wheat have stabilized. Why has that happened? We only have a handful of countries that are buying U.S. spring wheat right now, and almost all of them are Asia. Mexico is the exception. Mexico's actually come in and bought some. That's the one kind of growth potential is possibly Mexico for some spring wheat exports. Philippines by far is number one. Philippines is by far our number one customer for spring wheat. Okay. Now, USDA is forecasting a drop in both of those. Why? Because prices are so high. Again, the price of spring wheat relative to the price of winter wheat. Oh, and by the way, on a sidebar, you do not have to have spring wheat in a loaf of bread to make a good loaf of bread. You can do it with winter wheat only. It works better if you put some spring wheat in, but you can make a loaf of bread with winter wheat only. They're just fine. Now, if you're gonna make pizza dough or a bagel, you gotta have spring wheat. So the substitution is limited. Let's look at spring wheat prices compared to history. Now, let's ignore what happened in 2008. Everybody remembers the $25 durum and the $20 spring wheat. Guys, it ain't coming back. That was an anomaly. There was a weird set of events that created that, so let's just forget about that. Let's look at what would be a normal or typical price range for spring wheat, and where are we today? Now, this is old crop, not new crop. And right now, there's a pretty big old crop, new crop spread. There's strong incentives to sell your spring wheat now, but personally, this is, I hate to give advice, I usually don't do this. I would not be very aggressive in booking spring wheat, 2022 spring wheat prices yet. I think this, in my opinion, I want to be very careful, in my opinion, I think the spring wheat market's going to work, have to work harder than it is right now to hold their acres and to be able to get the base back that they need. I don't think the spring wheat market has quite figured out how aggressive some of these other commodities have been in forward contracting. But they will. They will. So be cautious. Old crop, you know, I'm asking you why you're storing it. New crop, I'm saying, yeah, well, let's just wait a little bit and see what happens here. I think the downside risk is pretty low. Here's the problem we have for U.S. winter wheat. Now, this is winter wheat, not spring wheat. This is winter wheat, not spring wheat. For winter wheat, we still need to export about 50% of our crop. Looking at these numbers, who's going to buy U.S. hard red winter wheat? If I'm in the global market for winter wheat, why would I buy U.S. wheat? I mean, we're $10 a metric ton. That's $100 a metric ton, right? $100 a metric ton out of the market. I mean, usually a sale in the global market is made or broke by about $5 a ton. Why would anybody want to buy U.S. hard red winter wheat when you can get it out of either Ukraine or the Black Sea? Who's our number one buyer of hard red winter wheat? What country? This is important, guys, because what's limiting the upward movement of spring wheat is winter wheat, because that's price spread. Spring wheat can only get so far above winter wheat, and they won't buy spring wheat anymore. So when I talk to farmers and they ask me why isn't spring wheat higher, I point to winter wheat and say, because we got too darn much winter wheat and we're booked out of the international market in winter wheat. So who do we sell our winter wheat to? Number one customer is who? You need to know this. Mexico. So when we talk about exchange rates, the economic growth in Mexico, that has a direct impact on your spring wheat prices. Because if winter wheat goes up, that allows spring wheat to go up also. So here's some comments, some things that are going on. Then we'll open it up for questions. Hurricane damage out of the U.S. Gulf. One of the reasons we have the strong basis levels today in North Dakota is because some of the damage in the Gulf. So think about the choke point right now is the export elevators. We have a whole bunch of ocean freighters that have been backed up in the ports waiting to get loaded with grain. We also have barges full of grain trying to get into the Gulf ports to be unloaded, to be transloaded onto an ocean vessel. So we lost a bunch of time because of the power outages. So there was damage to facilities, but most of the problem and the slowdown was because of power. You know, if the power goes out, you're not going to run your legs. Right? You can't load a vessel. So yes, things are coming back up. They're not up to full capacity. It's going to take several months before it gets to full capacity. But we also have this backlog, both on the inbound as well as the outbound. So if you're a Cargill or an ADM or a Bunge or a Dreyfus, and you have an order of soybeans that need to be delivered to China, and all of a sudden your vessel is sitting in port and they're saying, no, we can't load it for a month, what do you do? You say, oh shoot, we better figure out a solution, right? Something like that. So where are they diverting loadings to? Where do you fill your orders from? USPNW or Brazil? And they're both going to be expensive. You're going to lose money on the deal regardless. It's just how much you're going to lose. Again, one of the reasons we have the strong basis levels is because the PNW needs more grain, both corn and beans. So it is coming back online. Brazil is also one of the, you probably heard reports that there's some U.S. Let's talk about Brazil and why Brazilian weather is going to be so important. Right now, Brazil produces and exports more soybeans than the United States by quite a ways. We're number two in the world for soybean production and soybean exports and have been for about 5 or 6 years. So when we talk about a 5% increase in soybean production in Brazil, this is what the trade is expecting. That's a massive number, folks. How many more acres of soybeans are we going to get in the U.S.? What's our growth rate? Could we put a 5% growth rate on our production of soybeans? No. Well, we could, but it would take a Herculean effort. Now, the corn number is a little misleading, a 37% increase in corn production. Now, that's a little misleading because the last year's corn crop in Brazil was not good. So we're starting from a lower level, but it's still a very substantial increase. Brazil is the second largest corn exporter in the world. The United States is still by far number one in corn exports, but Brazil is number two and they're gaining. So they're taking some of their acreage and putting it into corn. Now the corn crop you gotta be worried about is not the corn crop they're planting now, it's what they call the safrinha corn crop. It's the winter corn crop. They plant their winter corn crop before we do. We're usually planting in April and May, they're planting in about February, March. They're a little ahead of us in their production cycle. It's their winter, that's why they make it work. That's their big corn. About 70 to 75% of all the bushels of corn that Brazil produces is their winter corn crop. Okay, so if you hear about weather issues and problems coming up in the next several months, that's a soybean issue. If you hear weather problems coming up later in the season in that February, March, April time period, that's a corn problem. So timing makes a difference. Here's a current soil moisture map, at least an estimate. This is out of NASA. They actually do a really nice job of satellite imagery. It's that central producing region. Now realize way in the north of Brazil, I should have put a better map up, I apologize. In the northern part of Brazil is the Amazon jungle. Okay, Mato Grosso, which is a huge, huge producing state. It's the size of Iowa, Illinois, and Indiana put together. So it's a huge land area. That's their big soybean region. It's also growing into their corn region. The reds that you see, about half of that red is in Mato Grosso. So their corn and soybean producing region starts about just above that red zone and moves all the way down into the tip. Then you look at Argentina below that, and the entire country of Argentina is in trouble. They have Paraná River starts in Brazil and it kind of runs through and comes back and enters the ocean in Argentina. That's like their version of the Mississippi. Most of their loading facilities, most of their exports come along that river ports. They're now dredging the river because the water levels are so low. They can't load vessels full. They can load them about halfway in the river, and then they have to pull them out and reload to top them off by the time they hit the ocean. They're very dry. So this expectation we're going to get a big South American crop, watch this. The markets are going to still be paying attention. We're not quite focused on it yet because it's too early. Okay, last things. Then I'll open it up for whatever questions you want to talk about. In the last several days, and this is, I want to talk about the demand from China. The last several days, we've seen a lot of reports coming out of China that they're having power problems. The Chinese government put in some restrictions on coal production, coal mining, and they're now starting to hit. They work through their reserves. Energy prices, especially electricity, has skyrocketed, and there's actually outages and shortages. Northern China is where they process. They have a lot of their soybean crushing industries in North China. About half of their soybean crushing plants are closed down right now because they can't get power. What does that do to the demand for soybeans? Because they import almost all of their crushing soybeans. Their food-grade soybeans they produce domestically, but their crushing soybeans, almost 100% comes from the world market. Now, what that's doing is it's driving up feed prices in China. Pork prices have stabilized and falling, so the margins in producing pork right now are big negative. The pork farmers in China are hurting because their prices are down for their product, the input costs are soaring, and they're saying, what are we going to do? There was an announcement this morning. The Chinese government said, yes, we're going to have to increase our coal production. So they turned to all the coal mines and said, ramp it up, guys, because winter is coming and we don't want people to freeze. Does that mean there's going to be enough electricity for industry? Maybe, maybe not. Depends on how fast they can ramp back up. Again, supply and demand, right? If we start looking at a big crop out of Brazil and the demand base out of China is flat or shrinking, what does that do to soybean prices? Right. So I'm a little nervous right now about beans. Just, again, I'm not trying to cry wolf. I'm not trying to stand up here and say, guys, the sky is falling. But these are the things the market is watching today. So we could easily have a 50 cent per bushel cut in soybeans and a week later a 50 cent retracement. Soybeans are going to be volatile. Hang on. This is going to be a bumpy, bumpy ride. Freight rates. This is a chart of ocean freight. So this would be from loading in these different ports delivered to North Asia. Ocean freight has nearly doubled since January. Now this is bulk freight. This isn't containers. A lot of the stuff you've seen in the news is talking about containers and containerized product. I did an international program last week, and there was a guy that, a U.S. shipper that uses a lot of containers for some specialty products. He said, normally we can get containers for about $3,000 a container. That's kind of the typical number they budget in for transportation. He said, I got a bid a few days earlier. It was $13,000 per container, and they couldn't guarantee they could deliver it. This is bulk freight. The bottom line, that bottom red one, is PNW. So rephrase that. If trucking rates suddenly doubled, and you're a truck driver, what is your incentive? Get as many miles on as possible, as fast as possible. Where do you want to load and where do you want to unload? You want to load someplace fast, you want to unload someplace fast. The more trips you can make, the better off you are. Right now, PNW is the place to buy grain from, especially if you live in North Asia. So high freight rates also give PNW an advantage. I know that seems counterintuitive, but the total amount shipping might drop, but the volume out of PNW might increase because that's the place to get grain from. Does that make sense? Questions? A lot to absorb. But these right now are the core things that the markets are looking at. I want to try and share the information and the things that they're trying to evaluate and saying, as we move forward, what is prices going to do from here on? And I don't have a clue where we're headed. I got an opinion, but I don't know. But these are the things everybody's watching. Questions? You're either sleeping or confused. Yes. Okay, so if I heard you right, the question was, given what we see today and, again, the drought that we had in the area, some very aggressive contracting coming out for some of these specialty crops, you know, what does that mean for these acres? So let's talk. Each of those is slightly different. The dynamics is slightly different. The ones that are hurting the worst right now, the industries that are hurting the worst right now, canola, malt barley, flax, and oats. Those are the ones that are really struggling to try and get supplies, and their supply chain is kind of breaking down on them. Now, canola is out hard with some very good attractive contracts. The guys that buy canola and process it also buy sunflower and process it, so they're making sure that they get their needs covered for sunflower, especially the oilers. Malt barley, I've only heard of one or two contracts out for malt barley. The first reaction was the farmers or growers, the farm managers were disappointed. They were expecting higher. So I think the malt barley guys might have to take a step back and do another run at it. I've only seen or heard one flax contract out. And it was amazing. I mean, that was a wow. That was much better than I expected. I don't know what the volumes are, and I don't know anything about the company that, again, I don't know which company put it out. Okay, so whenever you're contracting, counterparty risk is a big deal. Oats, I'm starting to get some questions from the oats guys saying, what do we need to do to get our acres? So what's happened is all of those crops that I just listed had very comfortable reserves built, and most of it was on-farm storage. Farmers were sitting with the inventory. With the low yields we got this year, we've cleaned out the inventory. And now they're looking at saying, we need to make sure we book enough production for our needs next year and trying to rebuild some inventory, because we can't run on pipeline all the time. So when you look at the spring wheat market, Durham also fits within that category, but there's some uncertainty on Durham because of the Canadian crop. We're still trying to figure out the quantity and quality of the Canadian crop, which is about, I don't know, give or take 10 times the size of North Dakota's crop. So the spring wheat, what I'm saying is the spring wheat market and the major buyers and traders, I don't think have realized how aggressive some of these minor crops, these smaller market crops, are going to be to hold their acreage base. I think the assumption is because it's dry, fertilizer costs are high, people switch out of corn and into spring wheat, we'll be able to hold our acres, we don't have to put much effort into it. I'm not convinced they've really figured out the dynamics going on in these smaller market crops. Like, oh, well, we can steal some from peas. We can steal some from, you know, fill in the blank. Because they've always been able to do that. Okay, I'm getting the big hook here. So thank you, guys. I'll be hanging around for a little bit. If you got questions you want to talk privately, I'd be happy to visit. Thanks for your time and attention.
back. We're going to do a couple of door prizes before we start our next session and hear from Tracy Kennedy. First things first, this was left on the bus yesterday to Blackleg Ranch. Does this look familiar, sir? Yeah, thank you. We have we've been doing door prizes, and Dorothy Lick is so sweet and kind that she realized that the people that were watching virtually hadn't won any prizes either. So hello, everybody. Should we say hello to everybody watching virtually? Hello! Congratulations to Megan Lawrence and Kyra Erovic. You've both won Starbucks gift cards. Congratulations, and thanks for joining us. More door prizes here at the event. And what's up first? You can come get whatever you want. You have Starbucks cards, chippers, and wine to choose from. Isn't that cool? So come on up when you hear your name and grab whatever you'd like. Dustin Nagel from Dakota Heritage Bank in Hillsboro. Dustin, come on up. Steve Stockwell from Stock Growers Bank in Milner, North Dakota. Come on up. Blaine Anderson from Alaris in West Fargo. Come on up, Blaine. Don Wiedner from American Bank Center in McCluskey. Congratulations. Come on up and get a prize of your choice. Brandon Reams from Choice Bank in Bismarck. Brandon, come on over and get your prize. Ethan Olson from Choice Bank in Bismarck. Congratulations. Ethan, come get a prize. Gage Dunn from Choice, what deal with Choice Bank all of a sudden? Gage Dunn from Choice Bank in Lemoore. Gage, come on up and get a prize. Matt Marsh from Farmers and Merchants Bank of Tallna, North Dakota. Come on up and get a prize. Ryan Dusick from Bremer Bank in Grafton. Ryan, come on up. And Garrett Becker from Bremer Bank in Rugby, North Dakota. Garrett Becker, Rugby, come on up and get a prize. Congratulations to all our winners. We got a whole bunch of door prizes to give away, so we're going to do the same thing again between speakers. Well, we are really happy to have Tracy Kennedy with us this morning, everyone. Tracy Kennedy is a principal shareholder at Zimney Foster PC in Grand Forks and counsel for the North Dakota Bankers Association. She has more than 20 years' experience in banking law, commercial and business law, creditors' rights, and agricultural lending and credit transactions. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Tracy Kennedy. Tracy, come on up.
Thank you. Yes, right now I'm going to talk about the last legislative session, some of the new state laws that were enacted, some of the state laws that weren't enacted, and we'll talk a little bit about the federal climate when it comes to agriculture as well. So, I don't know if you've been on the NDBA website, but you've seen through the last legislative session, we would do weekly updates on what was happening in Bismarck, the bills that were introduced, where they stood, what NDBA's position was on those bills, what bills that NDBA put forward. And we have all of that, and we have a comprehensive legislative wrap-up with that as well. But I really wanted to take this opportunity to tell you how the sausage was made. Because I think it's so important, and we're all here together, and I really, really, really need each and every one of you in the room to understand what NDBA does, and frankly, how important each and every one of you in this room is to the laws that get made in this state. So one of the questions I have gotten a lot since I became counsel for North Dakota Bankers Association is, are you still doing your regular practice? That was the thing that came about for the first couple of years. Yes, I do have my regular practice, and it is thriving, and I enjoy it, and I enjoy working with a lot of you in the room. Very much greatly appreciative of that. And the next question that I always get is, how much time do you spend in Bismarck? And that goes to, I want to take this opportunity to tell you how NDBA works for you and makes legislation. So this is essentially how it goes. Mid-2018, I came on as counsel for North Dakota Bankers Association. I took over for the irreplaceable Marilyn Foss, who had all of those years of experience and was really effective in Bismarck for all of you. So I come in mid-2018. We're preparing for the 2019 legislative session, and she always took a big part in that. So 2019 legislative session comes through. I had never even been to a legislative session, quite frankly. And it in 2019, if you remember, it was in January, February, it was like 30 below every single day. Do you guys remember that? 30, 36 below. And so a lot of times when I was going to come over to testify, it just wasn't physically possible. And so what Rick and I started to do was I started working more so on the written testimony. So when Rick goes to testify in Bismarck, he will give up and he will submit written testimony to the committees to take into consideration. And then he'll explain that and he will testify about what NDBA does or doesn't want to happen with a particular bill. I did get away one time to testify, and it was literally 35 below when I drove over, and it was on the grain warehousing statutes and the changes that NDBA wanted to see with that. And I got there, and I was explaining to John Schumacher, I got there, and it was freezing. My husband really wasn't happy that I was traveling on that day as well. And I get ready to testify, and one of the committee members wouldn't even look at me, and he was just very rude. And if anybody in the room knows me, and I kind of warned this before, I kind of got like that fight or flight thing, and I'm a fighter. And so when he was really going at me and being very rude, the only thing I had on the tip of my tongue was, listen, you blank 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 blank, I drove 4 hours and 35 below, and but anyway, Rick came in and Rick said, you know, this is what we're doing for NDBA, and we leave the session, and I said, well, that blank, 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 I was so angry, and Rick said, you know, he's really a nice guy. I'm like, really? So from then on, Rick and I really just kind of made sure that we did the best thing for NDBA, and so we in Grand Forks, my team and I, we do a lot of work behind the scenes, and we try to do it as early as possible to write legislation or to oppose legislation, to have the clearest, most concise written testimony on your behalf. And Rick is amazing at his communication skills because, and he's not here today, and doesn't have the ability to tell you this, but Rick sincerely likes people. And Rick sincerely sees the good in all people. And Rick knows how to cooperate with interested parties to get good legislation done. And he works with other industries to get good legislation done. He is tireless, and he showed that in the last legislative session. I would stay behind in Grand Forks, work on written testimony. But Rick literally would put us together with interested groups and people on the other side, too, for the single purpose of coming to a common ground and making good legislation. And I was so in awe of him in this last legislative session. So I wanted to go down some of the things that we did and that Rick did and the differences. And I want to show you what goes into these laws that are made. The other thing I want to impress upon each and every single person in the room when we're talking about the laws, NDBA, we sponsored three pieces of legislation. One, we worked directly with the Department of Financial Institutions. Lisa Cruz came in about the same time that I did, and she felt comfortable enough to go to Rick and say, you know what, we've got this loophole in our statutes. And I'm afraid that some of our auditors are getting into bank records and bank customer records. And I'm not crazy about it, Rick. Can you help us write some legislation to tie up that loophole to better protect your customers? Rick said, you betcha. So that's what we did, is we worked together on that particular piece of legislation. The next piece of legislation that we sponsored was dealing with burial accounts. Now, there were some changes in the law in 2019 dealing with burial accounts. And what happened after that, you know, completely went past our radar in 2019, you know. It was brought forth by the funeral home associations, and it wasn't titled about burial accounts as much as it was about prepaid funerals. But when it happened, when this legislation went into place, what happened was I was getting calls as counsel from your frontline people. It turns into, first it's one call, and then it's two calls, and it's three, four, five. And what happened was the North Dakota Department of Health and Human Services started writing letters to people that got Medicaid and Medicare assistance and said, hey, you will become ineligible unless you change this burial account, because the way that the law changed, it took these burial account funds, and it that used to be somewhat protected from the calculation of what state assistance elderly received, and it brought it back in. They had to be changed in the according to this new law. So I must have had 10 calls and emails to see, oh my gosh, something is terribly wrong here. What do we do? And then the incorporation later, we tried to do our best with that. Again, another phase of this rolled out. So what happened, what I'm trying to tell you is this piece of legislation that we sponsored came directly from your frontline people, okay? So that's where you all come in. It came right from your frontline people. And Rick and I, you know, I wrote the legislation, tried to fix it. It took, you know, some time and whatnot. But Rick worked directly then with the state's funeral home association, because they're the one that wrote the bad law. And in true Rick fashion, got them to come to the table. And Rick also worked directly with the state Health and Human Services as well, and got them to the table so that we could work together for a consensus and rewrite and fix that law together. So proud of that. The next thing that we did was the mortgage expiration and extension and modification. So it was how North Dakota's mortgages are written, or at least the statutes dealing with mortgages. They're not real clear about the ability to extend a mortgage past the 10-year statute of limitations on a mortgage. And so this actually came from my partner, John Schrader. He said, you know, Trace, now that you're working with NDBA, I don't like this law. It really bugs me. I'm like, okay, write up something. And I took it to the legislative committee, and they said, gosh, that does sound like it needs to be fixed. So again, Rick worked with, quite a few people. North Dakota Title Standards Committee helped out on that, made it a little bit better. State Bar Association helped out on that, made it a little bit better. And different attorneys throughout the state helped out and supported Rick in his testimony to get that done, to make sure that we have really strong, valid mortgages that will work specifically too. I mean, for agriculture, you know, we extend those mortgages out, don't we? And so we did that, and I'm very happy about that. Oh my gosh. We also supported and worked hard on several other pieces of legislation, the Revised Uniform Unclaimed Property Act, the disposal of abandoned personal property. That was really good. Rick worked hard on that. Ag warehousing, I did testify in some interim committees, and I did drive over to Bismarck, and that was helpful. But when push came to shove on that one, Rick brought us together with Farm Credit, with Ag Country, and ICBND, and we worked together to make sure that banks were protected with the ever-changing legislation in that department. So, repairman's liens. We, that was something that really could have been a problem for all of you. And we worked really hard. And that's, I think, one of the times that I saw Rick Clayburgh and really appreciated his communication skills, because that was something, the repairman's liens, the automotive dealers and whatnot in the state who do the repairman's liens for motor vehicles and farm equipment brought a piece of legislation that really wasn't so great, and it wasn't going to be great for you guys. And Rick was able to bring together a group of people, allow me to virtually testify in front of the committee and explain to them the laws of the Uniform Commercial Code, what the repairmen should need to do as far as notice and all of that. So Rick brought us all together with that. Not only did he bring us all together with that one, he, in his communication style, really, I don't know, did a lot better job than, say, the director of the Credit Union Association. That individual was very, Jeff, was much more argumentative and just didn't have the communication style that Rick did. And I really think that we would have had a very bad piece of legislation if it wasn't for Rick allowing us to provide unbelievable written testimony. That you can imagine, if you're legislators and people are coming in asking you to do this, that, and the other thing, the written stuff, yeah, people come in and they talk about it, but they leave with very clear and concise written testimony, and that's me. but Rick was able to work with all parties involved and not in an argumentative way. As a matter of fact, he worked late into the night before a hearing committee, even though the very next morning, I'll never forget, like 9 a.m., he was scheduled for surgery. So he's working till 10 o'clock, making sure we had everything right, and I was gonna be available to testify, and he's worried about it. And it's like, I think his surgery is like 8 a.m., and like 10 a.m., I'm getting texts from him, and I'm thinking, should you really shouldn't be thinking about this or being on your phone, but that was his level of dedication, and we would have had bad law without Rick. The legacy fund, wow, that was something that is gonna be slow going, but I think we can get to something really good to keep those legacy dollars, not only, in the state, but in the state with some of our state banks. I know that this is something that he is working very hard on. There is an interim study. We will likely be reaching out to some of you to help us fight to get those funds invested in North Dakota banks instead of with banks outside of the state. So that's a big thing for us. We're really pushing. But let's talk about bills that were defeated. Oh my gosh, you guys have no idea. things move fast in Bismarck. And, you know, again, Rick boots on the ground and me over in Grand Forks. We would have calls all the time on some of these things. But a really bad one was this anti-mortem of probate and duties of PRs and personal representatives and actions against trustees. I want to bring up this one. It was absolutely a horrible bill, but the driver on the opposition of this was Bell Bank's trust department. And if it wasn't for Bell Bank's trust department, again, reaching out to NDBA, working with us and working with their counsel, Tim Richards, who assists them, Tim Richards out of Fargo, there would have been some really bad legislation passed. So that's a credit. What I'm trying to say is that's a credit to all of you and to help us make better legislation and protect against bad legislation. There was a fella had a bill, and it was moving down the tracks to either prohibit deeds in lieu of foreclosure or to require a bank that took a deed in lieu of foreclosure to continue with foreclosure. It was very personal to this fella, and he gave testimony. You can see the testimony for some of these bills. And this fellow came up, and he had a long history. I don't know. I think he had been to the North Dakota Supreme Court like 3 or 4 times on this issue, and he was very passionate, and he was very hurt by it. And he had a legislator agree with him, so they brought this forth. And you know, we had written testimony on that. We worked with other entities, and Rick stood up and testified right after this gentleman, and couldn't have done it with, you know, better grace and style. And so that was defeated. The other thing that was defeated was something that I didn't realize is things get slipped into committees and bills get changed on the fly. And there was this one bill, I can't even remember what it started being about, but halfway through, they were going to create a mandatory farmer lender mediation for banks. Not lenders, not credit unions, banks. And so we did a lot of quick work on that, and that was defeated as well. We talked about bills that absolutely needed to be killed. These are things that were out there this year and were rolling down the tracks. I know if we hadn't worked hard, they would have gotten passed. Ah, can you imagine? So that's what happens when in the state legislature, and that's how we get things done. So why am I bringing it up? I'm bringing it up because here we are all sitting together, and things are changing quickly. And if you see things that you question about our state laws or how we're doing things or how things could be improved, communicate that to us. We will be getting together with a legislative committee probably in May of next year and looking at some of these things. So if things need to be changed, they get started by all of you, whether it's your tellers opening up accounts or things that you're dealing with on a daily basis on every single level, HR, trust, and ag lending in general, business lending, all of that. Just communicate with us because we have this team that is so unbeatable. And if you can communicate and you can give us some time, we're really gonna do a great job for you. I know it. And it's such a joy to be a part of. And so I thank you for letting me do that and be a part of that. So let's talk about one of the things that I talked about in my breakout session, one of the changes that is big that happened was the changes in grain buying and ag warehousing. And I know I brought it up and it's in our materials, but I think the biggest takeaway on that is for your farm customers, they need to know that when they're selling grain, that they have 30 days to turn their scale tickets into either a sales contract, you know, like to get paid, turn it into an ag warehouse receipt to agree to warehouse their grain and pay for storage, which nobody does anymore, or sign a credit sale contract or a price later contract, whatever you want to call it. And the new law in 2021 that took effect in August 1st allows for electronic signatures of credit sale contracts. But if they don't take their scale tickets and convert them within 30 days, they will lose protection under the state's state's credit sale indemnity fund. 30 days isn't a long time, and I don't know how they're going to communicate this to the Grain Growers Association. I don't know if NDSU will be putting anything out for this, and I don't know where we stand for this year's crop season, quite frankly. And it's only important if the grain, if the elevator goes insolvent. So let's all just hope that that doesn't happen this year. Make sure you, when you're meeting with your people and they're selling on a deferred payment schedule, that they understand that they've got to get their scale tickets converted. They must sign these contracts within 30 days. The other new thing that came out of that statute or that new law was that the Ag Commissioner's Office is requiring that any elevator that sells or purchases, I should say, on a credit sale type basis, deferred payment basis, has to offer to their customer, to the farmer, a bond option. So giving them the option to buy bond insurance coverage for that credit sale. So this is one of the things that I talked about with them in the interim committee meeting, because I was hoping that they would just beef up the protections under the credit sale indemnity fund. And one of the people in the committee said, so you're telling us you think there should be some sort of insurance for people that market their grain. I'm like, well, there's crop insurance. And so this is another tool that you have. You know, you do require your farmers quite often to purchase crop insurance, right? And so if they are marketing grain in amounts over $280,000, you might want to consider a requirement of bond purchasing, because that is supposed to be made available to farmers through our North Dakota elevators. So that's kind of what happened on a state level. I want to focus too on the importance of everybody in this room dealing with Capitol Hill. We had Ed from ABA speak to us yesterday about ECORA, and I remember afterwards yesterday everybody said, ECORA, wow, what does that mean? What exactly is this? ECORA is something that was introduced on Capitol Hill in, it was maybe the end of February, the first part of March 2019. And Nicole, is Nicole still with us? Is Nicole still in the room? Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't even talk to you about this. But here's the deal. You want to talk ECORA? Look over at Nicole over there. So we go out to Washington, D.C. at a Capitol Summit for North Dakota Bankers Association. You probably see, and it's the opportunity for banks to send some of their people to go to Washington, D.C., hear from the policymakers, and to meet with our congressional delegation. We go every year except for last year. And this year. Okay. We go every year except for the last 2 years. And when we went in 2019, I'll tell you what happened. There was talk through ABA about this new thing called ECORA. And it was a tax credit to banks, or that banks wouldn't get taxed on the real estate. And I think Ed did a really great job explaining this. So that was the first time we heard about it as a group. We go in and we meet with Kelly Armstrong, Kevin Kramer, John Hoven. And we're all there together. And the night before we go to Capitol Hill, we decide who's going to be talking about what. And we look over at Nicole and we're like, you're taking ECORA. And she's like, all right, I got this. And so we walk into Kramer's office, Hoven's office, Armstrong's office. And Rick says, you know, and we want to talk to you about something new, something brand new that's going to be coming, and we want your support on it. It's called ECORA. And they all do one of these. What's ECORA? And Nicole Evanson from Garrison, North Dakota, stands up, takes the lead, and she says, this is ECORA, and this is why I need it. I'm a banker in Garrison, North Dakota, and I take care of my community. I put dollars back into my community. I take care of my customers. I have their accounts. I answer their questions. I help them when they need funds for a car and this and that. And when I go to make ag loans, I will lose them to farm credit because I can't match their interest rate. If I had ECORA, I could do everything. And they do one of these. They were so receptive, weren't they? They were so receptive, and they wanted to know more. And they wanted to hear it not from as amazing as Rick would be so happy to hear me talk about it, but they didn't want to hear from me, and they didn't want to hear from Rick Clayburgh. They wanted to hear from Nicole Evanson of Garrison, North Dakota, because she is their constituent. We got back, and it was a couple of weeks later, and when this bill was introduced in the Senate, it had two co-sponsors on it. It had Kevin Kramer and it had John Hoven. And I called Nicole and I'm like, you wouldn't believe it. Oh my gosh, you did it. And maybe they would have co-sponsored it anyway, but it made a big difference. Your voice makes a difference. It makes a difference not just for the state, it makes a difference in Capitol Hill. So what does all of this mean? It means all of us together need to continue to communicate, to ask questions. You guys can email me questions at any time. Questions, concerns, complaints. Why is this this way? Why is this that way? And questions. Now, as far as the Acora stuff, we've published at North Dakota Bankers Association at least two white papers on this, one of which I supplied to Ed to give him a different perspective when he was pushing it in D.C. So we can put those on the Ag Committee's website for this conference, and you can read those. If you have any concerns or anything you want to bring up regarding that, that would be great. We already have a couple of really great, strong proponents, or three of them, on Capitol Hill for this. But I'm thinking about some of the people in the room. I was talking to John Rentz yesterday, you know, and you guys have, other people will have, banks will have presence in Minnesota, in South Dakota. We've got North Dakota on board. They're going to be a champion for it. But let's see if we can get some of these other state senators and representatives to go along with this as well. Lastly, you know, I wish we could have gone out there this year. The whole thing that I wanted to tell them, or even it was last year, we had all of these things we wanted to thank our congressional delegation for, not only just ask them for things, but things we wanted to thank them for. It might be a terrific opportunity, if we're all super in favor of ECORA, to do some sort of joint letter to our congressional delegation going, yes, thank you for supporting this. This is big for us. And see if we can get that pushed through. So, am I done? I have 5 minutes. Okay, I don't have my glasses on. I can barely see back there. It looks like this or this. So, with all of that said, and my little rah, rah, rah speech, it is true, and you do make a difference. So, does anybody have any questions for me? Our next legislative session will be 2023. Any questions? Oh, great, thanks. Sure. You know, I talked about this on Wednesday on Ask Kennedy, and we did publish some information on this as well. You know, I was and Rick called me afterwards, and he said, you know, you didn't quite get it right. I'm like, well, I tried. and Rick says, you know, Trace, let's just keep an eye on this because, you know, it might not go anywhere. But if you want more information on what the IRS is proposing, we do have a fantastic link on Wednesday's Ask Kennedy in a nice white paper on that. But again, Rick said, you know, it will go into more of the annual reporting, and it's bad because of this and that, and he did correct me on a lot of things when it came to that. But he said, you know, I don't think this is something for us to get fired up about yet, is exactly what he told me. So, yeah, great question. Any other questions? Well, if you don't want to ask me questions up here, you know, we can meet any other time. And my email, my NDBA email, is always open. And yeah, thanks for having me. Thanks for letting me be a part of the conference.
Thank you very much, Tracy. Always a pleasure to hear from you. North Dakota Bankers Association is fortunate to have you working with us as well, and we thank you very much. Great job, Tracy. We're going to take a break in just a second, but before we do so, let's give away some more fun prizes. Are you ready? And once again, when you hear your name, if you just come on up and just select whatever prize that you'd like, okay? Nicole Evenson from Garrison State Bank and Trust in Garrison. Okay. Ryan Hoffman, First International Bank and Trust in Fargo. Casey Carlson, Dakota Bank in Rolla. There's Chippers, Starbucks, gift cards, and wine to choose from. Rory Tim, Unison Bank in Jamestown. Rory? Roger Irby's, American Federal Bank in Moorhead. Bobby Foster, Ramsey National Bank in Devil's Lake. Brent Malm, State Bank of Botno in Botno, North Dakota. Cale Paulson from Dakota Heritage Bank in Harvey. And Jeff Granos from Cornerstone Bank in Watford City. Jeffrey. We're going to take 5 minutes, run to the bathroom, get some more coffee, whatever you'd like to do. And our final speaker, Delaney Howell, will be up at that time. We'll give away a few more door prizes. So let's make it 5 sharp minutes, okay? 5 minutes. once again. It's a gift card. From a John Merchant Traverse. Come on up.
do you do? What's that next generation look like? Do you have a succession plan? And unfortunately for us, we didn't really have a firm succession plan in place. So Dad came to each of us, there's myself and my two brothers, came to each of us individually and said, hey, this is a decision we've had to make. It wasn't an easy one, obviously, but we're going to have to look at letting the family farm go. And he told me last, he said he was least excited to tell me because he knew I would be the most upset out of that decision. And so when he came to us and told us that, my fiance and I were sitting at the kitchen table with him and thinking, my first reaction was, I want to buy the farm. Because obviously I had a strong emotional connection to it. I grew up on this farm. I had lots of memories raising livestock and showing cattle. And so from an emotional perspective, I wanted to do it. I wanted to farm it. I was gonna buy the homestead. Maybe we're gonna do cattle. I don't know. I didn't have the details figured out quite yet. It was a shock a little bit at that time. But I also wanted to be smart about that decision. So Blaine, my fiance, and I started gathering production data from my dad. And some of the folks I had dinner with last night know my part of Southeast Iowa is not really ideal for growing corn and soybeans. We're known for growing two commodities in Southeast Iowa, but it's not corn and soybeans. We're known for growing watermelon and cantaloupe because the area where I'm from in Southeast Iowa is very sandy soil. So it doesn't hold water well. Usually in wetter years, we do pretty phenomenally, but in years where there's a little bit of drought, crops don't do well. So we're sorting through production records and we're seeing yields of 50, 80, in a good year, 150, and we're talking yields for corn. So I would say average yield was somewhere around 80, 90 bushels per acre, where most of Iowa's sitting at, you know, 200 acres or 200 bushels per acre plus. So I wasn't gonna let that deter me. We keep going through the process. We pull more data. We're looking at input costs. What would rent be if we, you know, extended past what we owned and did some cash rent. And it wasn't until we had the meeting with our insurance agent slash banker that I kind of had that aha moment. He's sitting down, he's walking us through the numbers. He's not sharing with us yet what his opinion is about what we should do with the farm. But he's basically lining up all this data for us that says, if you rent the farm, A, you're probably not ever going to make money, and B, if you do, you really are only going to make money because you as a first-time producer in Loisa County would be guaranteed the county APH yield. And so it was at that moment that I had a light bulb click on for me because I've worked in the industry, you know, commodities slash reporting for almost 10 years now, but it wasn't until that conversation back in early 2020 that I had that light bulb moment in understanding finally what so many farmers go through when they're trying to make those tough decisions. There's obviously a very strong emotional component to what farmers do, to what we do, but does it make sense financially? And so it's kind of in that mindset that I like to try and speak to banking groups, speak to other groups. I get to talk to a lot of banking groups throughout the year. I would have to say this banking group, and I'm not just saying this to say this, is probably the most diverse as far as gender and age of people that I've been to this year, which is exciting, I think, that you guys have such a well-versed group of people that are excited to get into ag lending. And with that, I think you have the ability to work with producers and help them make those tough decisions. My banker didn't tell me I shouldn't buy the farm. I had to make that realization on my own, but he was a trusted partner in helping us get to that point to make that decision. And for those of you wondering, no, we did not buy the family farm. It was not going to pencil out. So with that being said, I want to continue on here and talk about a few of the current headwinds, a few of the fundamental factors driving the commodity markets right now. And I know some of these have already been touched on by a few of your other speakers, so we won't spend too much time talking about these. But we'll start here talking about weather. We've got to talk about black swan events, such as COVID-19. Trade and supply and demand, where we're sitting at there, we've got to talk about, well, we don't need to talk about, I think Ed did a great job of that, updating you on some policy. And then we also, of course, need to talk about black swan events and how those relate to where current commodity prices are. So let's start here by looking at weather. You'll see this chart. I have to apologize. I didn't get these slides sent in, but Dorothy has a copy of them if anyone wants them after. But this chart right here shows 2019 weather events that impacted agriculture. And there were quite a few of them. As you can see here, we've got tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, wildfires, drought, just a large variety of weather events happened in 2019. To add up to the balance sheet here, about $46 billion in agricultural losses in 2019. And I'll share one more quick story here because I like to pick on my dad. He was a great cattleman, not a great row crop slash marketer. And he knows that, he'll admit it. But in 2019, maybe not so much here in North Dakota, but especially where I was from in Iowa, Southeast Iowa, we had a ton of rain that year. That was the year when we saw, you know, dams break up north. We saw a lot of flooding in Nebraska and Iowa, and we had a really rough year to get that crop in the ground. I see some of you shaking your head, remembering back to that. Yes, it was not a fun time, but it did present us with some exciting markets at that point. And so I remember having this conversation with my dad, and farmers are the eternal optimists. They're always long the markets, I get it. But I remember having a conversation with my dad. I'm talking to him, I'm flying home from a speech. I don't remember what group I'd spoken to at that time, but we're talking about the commodity markets and we're talking about my outlook. And he's saying, well, what do you think we should do? Should we sell now? Should we wait? I said, Dad, let's sell. I think at that time, you know, markets were trading above $4. His break even was like $3.65, so we were gonna make some money. And again, we don't have a lot to work with in Southeast Iowa, so let's make some money while we can. And we're having this conversation, and he's talking to me about his logic, what he thinks is gonna happen. He said, no, you know, I just don't think I can sell anything yet. He's like, look how wet everything's been this year. We've seen a lot of farmers having issues getting planted. He's like, nah, I'm not gonna sell. I think corn's gonna go to $5 or $6 this year. I said, okay, done arguing. It's your crop. Don't rub this in his face, but the high that year for the markets was posted in the July contract at $4.73. So we did not hit $5. Dad missed out on some marketing opportunities, as I'm sure many other farmers did, but I think his mindset is very common among farmers, and maybe you guys deal with some of these as well. They always want to be able to take advantage of that market rally, and they want to hit the top every time, but that's not realistic. So what information can you take back for them today that allows them to say, hey guys, let's not aim for the very top of the market. The chances of that happening are very slim. Let's make money. Let's be worried about what number you need to hit to pull the trigger, because the biggest barrier in my experience has been that psychological trigger of pulling just one sale. You got to make one sale and then you get past that barrier for the year. Dad couldn't do it at that time. He couldn't pull the trigger. We missed out on some market opportunity, but that was his choice. He was okay with it. And so I think a lot of farmers have that mindset. So 2019, again, we set ourselves up here for a wet year. We saw still pretty good yields coming out by the end of the season, but we did have a little bit of shorter expectations. We didn't have the bumper crop maybe we were originally expecting. Then you couple that with in 2020, just last year, we again had a lot of inclement weather that impacted the farmer's balance sheet. Yields, again, were not at record levels. We saw good yields coming out of quite a few areas, but not to the yields that we originally expected. 2020's total farm damage from agriculturally related weather events total about $22 billion. So in total, 2019 and 2020, we're sitting around $65, $67 billion in agricultural losses. And of course, not all of that is from main commodities like corn, soybeans, and wheat. We saw some of that impact cotton and specialty crops as well, but we were setting ourselves up here to already have tight supplies heading into 2021. And so as you move forward here into 2021, those underlying fundamental factors were already setting themselves up here for where we're at here now in 2021, and we're going to touch on that a little bit more. But I wanted to also mention, so you got that going on in the United States, then you've got our South American production. And I don't know if your guy yesterday chatted too much about South American production, but I chat weekly with Eric Snodgrass, who works now with Nutrien Ag Solutions. He's a fantastic guy. I don't know if you guys have ever had the chance to hear him speak. He's phenomenal. Great speaker, makes weather interesting. And so I was just chatting with him earlier this week about South American production. We just got some updated outlook here for the country of Brazil. And so if you look at this map here, this one shows us the next 30 days, so basically October 15th to November 14th, what can we expect for South American production? And so I'll try to do this gracefully here, but you'll see right here that blue area is expected to get normal or more than normal rain. Down here in this browner area, we're expected to see drier than normal conditions. Their key season is right now for planting that major soybean crop. They just started planting September 15th. We're starting to see them make some headway there. But here's where the story gets interesting. This was the forecast long range, so we're talking out through the end of the year, basically. This was the long range forecast for South America as of September 1st. So you'll see again, green means a little bit more rainfall. Brown is drier. You'll look at the key down there at the bottom. So green's kind of average. Brown is less than average, maybe a little drier than usual. Right here. Then we have this one that just came out October 1st. And you'll see, I'll switch back and forth here so you can see, but look in that southern region of Argentina, Brazil, South America. Look how those patterns shifted just in 30 days. So I'm sure you guys have heard La Niña, right? That weather pattern that indicates hotter and drier conditions. And that's certainly true for South America right now. So the other thing I think that's interesting is when you look at this pattern right here, basically right where that circle is, and I'll do it on this side as well, right where that circle is, right where it's kind of starting to turn dark green into the black or into the brown and red. Those are the states that represent those common ones we hear when talking about soybean production in South America. Mato Grosso do Sul, Mato Grosso, Paraná. Those are the key soybean producing areas, and those are the ones right now setting themselves up for a hot and dry season. So we've got, again, kind of shifting winds right now. We're starting to see some better than expected yields coming out of fields this year. I was talking to some folks saying, you know, the eastern part of the state is getting 200 maybe bushel per acre yields. Western part obviously is dealing with some drought still, so maybe not quite as ideal. But then you look at states like Indiana and Ohio that typically don't put in fantastic yields, and we're starting to hear some numbers coming out of those fields that are just unheard of. So we've got these shifting winds, shifting dynamics, where the United States is probably going to produce a little bit more than we originally expected, but South America, they're setting themselves up for maybe not such a great season this year. So here's where things get interesting, even more interesting, I think. So you want to think back to 2012, when we saw kind of a super cycle in agriculture. Those prices, you know, we saw $8 corn, we saw significant prices in soybeans and corn. I've been reading a lot of market commentary, and I know Tommy said yesterday he was bullish. I'm bullish as well, and here's why. If we see any sort of a weather hiccup in South America, we're setting ourselves up for potentially some 2012, 13, 14 level prices, which is exciting, but also a little scary for folks like my dad who want to hit the top and probably aren't going to. So we've got to think about how can we take advantage of these potential rallies that are coming, obviously not right now with harvest pressure deflating the market, but January, February, March, April, next year, 2022, how do we take advantage of those potential rallies that are pending? And that's the big question mark, right? What strategies can you use with your producers to make sure that you're able to take advantage of some of those fantastic rallies that are potentially coming? Oh, going the wrong way here, 1 second. All right, so the other big thing we got to talk about is, you know, winter wheat country, spring wheat country, the folks that you guys work with dealing with some pretty significant drought right now. 41% of winter wheat country is in extreme drought. So you want to talk about markets that have exponential growth here. It's the wheat markets, especially that spring wheat market that's got a lot of bullish fundamentals driving it right now. But really, all of these things kind of add up to talking about black swan events. So when you think about a black swan event, we're talking about events that were unpredictable by any sort of analyst, broker, charts, something that just pops up that was unpredictable, such as COVID, which I know we're probably all very tired of talking about and hearing about. But unfortunately, that was a black swan event that's still playing out in the markets today. And so when you look at black swan events, we saw, potentially, days like when President Trump would tweet, you know, he's tweeting about black swan events. We see markets react to that. We saw extreme volatility during COVID-19 heading into this current administration, so much so that we had two of our biggest drops on the Dow Jones in just 1 year, two of the biggest extreme drops we saw just last year alone. So we've seen that potential question mark trickling into the ag commodities. We've seen that extreme volatility trickling into ag, and that leaves us with some exciting times, some times to be able to take advantage of these increasing prices. You know, since last harvest season, we've seen prices just skyrocket, which can make producers a little bit narrow-minded, narrow-visioned, thinking they want to hit the top. But that's not necessarily realistic. So again, what can you take back to them to say, hey, we're not going to hit the top, but here's where we should be sitting. Here's levels that we should be looking to pull the trigger at. And of course, that's different for every producer. But other black swan events that we saw, before I ask this, I'm hoping nobody is in the room named Karen. Do we have any Karens in the room? Or people's wives that are named Karen? Okay, good. I'm going to assume not. And if there are, this is not directed at you. But during COVID-19, we saw this huge shift, not only in markets, but also in consumer tastes and preferences. So I like to throw this one in here. It gets a few laughs. But you'll see here, basically in the 1990s, 1980s, we had scientists telling us what we should be eating and what we should be consuming and how we should be interacting with our food. Then we got a little less stringent, a little less worried, and we started letting PhD students tell us. And then the media. And then finally, here we are in the 2010, 2020 eras, and Karen on Facebook tells us what we should be feeding our families and how we should be, what we should be buying at the grocery store. So Karen, up until COVID, was telling folks that they needed to go green and eat plant-based alternative foods. I don't know if anyone in the room has tried plant-based foods. I've tried it just so I can know, and it's gross. I don't understand how it's healthier. If you look at the back of the label on like the Big Mac Whopper, whatever it's called, there's like 20 or 30 ingredients in there. There's how many ingredients in animal protein? One. I don't understand how that's healthier, but Karen on Facebook says it was healthier. So consumers were listening. Until we saw this black swan event, COVID, which pushed consumers to go back to the basics, go back to what they enjoy. I don't know how grocery stores were up here in North Dakota. I know toilet paper was a big one. Again, I don't understand why that flew off the shelves. But for those of you that purchase a little bit of protein at the store, did you guys see or experience when the shelves were bare? Maybe not quite this bare, but I'm the primary grocery buyer for my family. We don't buy a ton of it from the store. We usually just buy chicken because most of it we get butchered locally. But I was amazed when I would walk past the grocery store shelves at just how empty they were. Because when consumers are scared, when there's times of uncertainty, they're not going to eat the Big Mac Impossible Burger. They're going to eat and feed their families what they've always known to feed them, those safe, high-quality proteins that are affordable. So during COVID-19, we saw consumers start to shift back to those basics. We saw extreme strength in the protein markets, not only here domestically, but also internationally as well. So this chart here just shows you, basically over the past 5 years, where pork and beef exports sat. And if you'll look in the corners here, it's maybe a little hard to see from where you're sitting, exports for last year were phenomenal. Because it wasn't just consumers here in the United States listening to Karen, it was Karens all over the world finally being muted out by families thinking, hey, I don't know what's happening. I don't know if I'm gonna be able to get beef in a few weeks or a few months, so I've gotta buy it now for my family. They're not gonna remain sustained on eating plant-based alternative proteins. So we saw huge demand take off here in the United States and also domestically. We also still, just one more bullish factor for the protein markets, are seeing African swine fever play out in the global marketplace. We've just, you know, over the past month seen a case reported in Haiti and also the Dominican Republic, which is the first case here in the Northern Hemisphere in quite some time. So it's getting close to U.S. shores, which is certainly scary for producers. But on the Chinese side of things, we've seen them continuing to try to pick up pace and reproduce those hog herds again, but they're just not getting there. So we continue to see that remain supportive for the protein markets of not only just U.S. producers being able to feed the globe, but also China more specifically. And so that leaves us at where do we sit today for, hey, the folks I said last talked to last night said there weren't a ton of hog producers in the room, so we're going to skip doing that outlook. So where does that leave us for the beef side of things? We've seen a lot of excitement in the commodity markets, especially on the livestock side of things here. You'll see in both Dease Live Cattle and November Feeders, we've put in some short-term lows, at least in my opinion. We touched them here early on in the year on the live cattle side of things, and we recently here, November Feeders, just a couple weeks ago, put in a low, I think, for them as well. So long-term, what does that mean for producers, beef producers specifically? There is unlimited demand to come. There is demand ahead. People are not backing down from eating plant, or excuse me, from eating animal-based proteins. And the one wild card, right, and this is where you step in, is how do you help them protect against the risk that they're seeing right now in the feed markets? Because a lot of beef producers I've talked to lately say, yeah, prices are great, but corn prices are at levels that I didn't anticipate coming, and I have not protected myself. So what strategies can you employ to help them protect against that risk? Hedges, calls, and puts. We can trade the livestock markets. That makes guys nervous, I get it, but what can you do to help them think outside the box? What technology or resources should they be? Just like row crop farmers, beef producers should know their break-even cost, and that's always changing, of course, but they should be able to tell you guys that to the penny as well. I know that my dad sure could. He was not a great marketer, but he knew his break even. He knew his numbers. And so working with those producers to help them figure out, hey, we've got this potential coming. We've got some upside coming. May not be tomorrow. May not be right in line with how your production system works, but let's look at how we can lock in some of that coming profit. So that's on the protein side of things. And then we've also got one other kind of, as we're wrapping up the Black Swan events, on the more so crop side of things, we've got energy sector issues. Natural gas has just hit all-time highs since 2013. Oil is trading at almost $80 a barrel again. We've seen it come from trading negative last year during COVID to now being back up to some of its supported levels. So we're seeing these events trickle out here into, more importantly, the fertilizer market. And this one is a little one that's a little bit scary, I think, for producers, because we've seen basically since last year, fertilizer prices have been on a wild trend higher. I just was chatting with the StoneX director of fertilizer, Josh Linville, and if anybody's on Twitter, I would recommend following him because he tweets out some great stuff. But he's been sharing kind of this ongoing story of the black swan market for fertilizer. And just was chatting with him the other day, and I said, Josh, one, are we going to have supply shortages? Because it's not just the United States dealing with this issue. It's China dealing with this because of energy sector issues and big companies filing for bankruptcy. And, of course, China's a communist country, so they step in. China's dealing with these issues. Europe is dealing with these issues. The United States is dealing with these issues, not only from energy and production, but also transportation and logistics. I said, Josh, what's the story? Are we going to have a supply shortage? And he said, well, I can't predict the future, but I wouldn't bet my money against it that we won't have a shortage. So he thinks that's coming. He thinks producers, I said, okay, well, what do we do? Because this is not an ideal time to lock in fertilizer prices for fall application or 2022 use. He said, here's what I advise producers to do. He said, even if you're not gonna lock in that fertilizer now, you need to be telling your retailers that, hey, I still potentially am going to need this, either this fall or this coming spring. He said, if they're not telling their retailers right now that they're gonna need that fertilizer, there may not be any fertilizer left for them to snag. And then we're gonna be faced with that issue of does that pull acres in another direction? So we're kind of seeing this black swan event right now for fertilizer prices. What does that do to acres for next year? Do we see more acres being pulled into wheat production? Do we see producers trying to think outside of the box as far as fertilizer goes? And how does that fertilizer price, when we don't know what it's going to be yet, impact that input cost, that break-even cost of, hey, I need to be at least here before I'm ready to pull that trigger? So there's a lot of shifting winds going on right now that short term could push a lot of markets to feel pretty bearish. But again, longer term, we've got a lot of good fundamentals setting ourselves up here for some great prices come 2022. So as we're diving in again a little bit more to what's going to be impacting producers' balance sheets this year, we've got to talk about the health of rural America, because that's certainly been exciting as well. So you'll see here, agricultural exports for this year are expected to be up by about 16% this year. So certainly bullish for a producer's balance sheet. I was once told that about 20% of all producers' balance sheets can actually be tracked back directly to the export market, to those trade relationships we have. And so I don't know if Ed shared too much about the outlook right now with China, but of course we just got some big news out earlier this week that Representative Tai, Catherine Tai, has said that the Biden administration is working towards whatever phase two of the trade agreement looks like, and there's still a lot of question marks there. But as you look at that, that directly impacts the producer's balance sheet by about 20%. So then if you think back to especially 2020, also a big portion of that producer's balance sheet was what happened with farm subsidy money. So we had a record $46.3 billion in farm subsidies that were paid out in 2020. So producers are probably getting a little excited. I mean, I know none of them like to take it. They would much rather have trade, but that certainly helped to support a lot of farms last year and in 2019 as well. But as we're making those marketing decisions for 2022, we certainly cannot count on having any more government intervention. I know Tommy talked about inflation yesterday. That's going to be a key one that the administration is watching. They can't keep pumping in dollars like this, and agriculture certainly is no different than the rest of the general economy. So we're certainly not expecting to see a lot of that dollars getting pumped in, that additional CFAP, MPPP, whatever other acronym they want to throw at us, those things will not be pumped in to farm economy this year. So we've got to think about how can we be smart marketers and not rely on those subsidy payments. But then you look at net farm income. Even with that in mind, taking away those farm subsidy payments, net income of rural America is expected to be once again high, highest since 2013 is what we're expecting to see this year as far as net farm income goes. It's going to be increased by give or take 19.5% compared to 2020. So that just means a lot of producers are going to have a lot more dollars in their pocket. What are they going to do with those dollars? Are they going to buy equipment? Are they going to buy ground? Are they going to buy tillage or tile? Or what are they going to do with that money? That's, again, where you guys come in. How can they make smart decisions with that money, since we are going to see record income this year for producers? So that's where we get a little fun, I think. So I don't know how many of you guys have seen this in the news. Just earlier this week, a farm in Iowa, in Johnson County, which is right around the Iowa City, Cedar Rapids area, sold for a record $26,000 per acre. Ridiculously high. I don't understand why someone would pay that much for that. But basically, it was a small farm. I mean, it was only about 76 acres, one parcel. The other parcel sold for still $21,000, which is way above market where market value should be. Our hypothesis is that it's potentially going to go into commercial development, since it is so close to that Iowa City, North Liberty, Cedar Rapids area. It's a pretty good-sized metropolis for the state of Iowa. So we saw this record purchase. We saw an investor step in. But this wasn't the first time this has happened this year. About a month ago, we saw in Grundy County, Iowa, which is just one county over from where my fiance farms, farm sold for $22,000 an acre, which is going into farm ground. It is not going to be, there's nothing over there for it to get zoned into commercial for. So we were doing the math on that because, again, we just don't understand how that number ever makes sense when cash rent is not sitting, you know, at that high per acre. We found out that there was a couple windmills on that farm. And again, this one was about 80 acres that sold for that $22,000 per acre. So windmills were going to help cash flow the farm. But even after we did the math, we figured maybe there's some CRP ground. I don't know. Even after that, the cash rent on that thing was still going to be $400, $500 per acre. And I don't know any farmers, even with subsidy money, crop insurance money, that are can afford to make that work. So where do we see those extra dollars going into? I think farmland is going to be a big one. But does it make sense to buy farm ground for $26,000 per acre? Heck no, it doesn't. It better be 1,000 bushel per acre farm if that's the case, and we know that that's not going to happen. So again, how do we guide those dollars? Where do we put those dollars this year as we have a big chunk of extra income coming in? And I don't know how North Dakota farmers are, but Iowa farmers certainly do not like to pay taxes. So they're looking at the end of the year to say, do I need to defer income? Do I need to put this income somewhere else? It's going to be a good time to do that here. Have that conversation with your growers coming right up as we are trending through the end of harvest season. So I'll just throw this up here and let everyone read it for a second. I'm part of a Facebook group called the Grain Marketing Discussion, and anyone can join it. So if you guys are interested, I think there's a lot of producers that post a lot of interesting things on there. Maybe you can find some new potential customers. But it's mostly farmers talking about commodity markets and how they market and just different things. And a guy shared this meme the other day about, do you agree or disagree with this logic? And so basically he's saying, do you agree with the fact that this is how we market our commodities? And so then a big long post starts. But that got me to thinking too, you know, on my fiance's farm that I helped do some of the marketing decisions for, we've got two different mindsets when it comes to the marketing. We've got Blaine's dad, Dwayne, who's mid-50s. We've got Blaine, who's 30. So very different as far as levels of experiences, backgrounds, etc. And they have very different marketing styles as well. Dwayne is very similar to my dad. He wants to hit the market at the top. He wants to make sure that no rally is going to go without him. And Blaine is the opposite. Blaine likes to take risk off the table early. He might lock it in too soon, according to his dad, but we're in the mindset that let's take that risk off the table early, and let's be able to take advantage of that by buying calls or buying puts if we think it's going lower. So we'd rather trade on paper than have that physical risk sitting in the grain bin, sitting in the field. Dwayne is the complete opposite. I'm not saying one way is right or wrong, but we're at this time again when you want to talk about shifting winds. 70% of family farms are going to transition here over the next 10 to 15 years. So those 55, 65-year-old farmers are going to be passing it on to the 30 to 40-year-old farmers who have two very different visions about how to market those commodities. So here's another opportunity to step in and help with that role, with that transition. But as you continue on here to look at current grain prices, this is where we've got to talk about really what you take back to your producers. And so let's start here with one more quick poll. And that's get those phones out again. Same number, you'll text it. A, B, C, or D, or E, what percentage are your producers sitting at right now as far as marketing goes for new crop corn and soybeans? So just overall, where are they sitting? If you know, where's the majority of your producers sitting when it comes to their marketing decisions this year? Okay, so that's where I assumed they would come in. That was not all that different from a month ago when I was speaking to the Illinois Bankers Association. They answered very similarly. But then let's talk about what percentage should I be sold at. And I'll ask you one more question here before we get to that, because I also did a little poll of my own with some farmers. So how would you say most farmers do marketing on their own without using, let's say, any sort of advisor, them just shooting a number and trying to make the best marketing decisions? No advisor, no broker. How do they do on their own? So we got maybe one or two people that said good marketers. Nobody said excellent. And a lot of people said average to poor. Again, not surprised there. That's how most groups that I go to say. So let me show one more thing to you here. Let me throw one more thing your way. So I did a Twitter poll the other day to ask farmers, what percentage marketed are you right now heading into or in the heart of harvest season? So you'll see here, pretty similar poll numbers to what I shared here. 20%, 20 to 40, they kind of slowly scale down just like you guys answered. So your guesses were right in line with where producers answered. A lot of them are sitting at less than 20% and or 20 to 40% right now, which is great, assuming you don't sell right off the combine as a cash marketer. Because I think that's the other interesting thing we have a lot of farmers doing, my dad included. He did not do a great job marketing. We did not have a lot of on-farm storage. So come harvest time, he wasn't necessarily sold ahead. He didn't have bushels protected. He'd just sell it right off the combine, which is literally the worst time you can sell your crop. The worst time. Aside from maybe last year when we saw counter-seasonal rallies, this is the worst time to sell your crop. Basis, I heard, was maybe getting a little stronger up here, but in our neck of the woods, it is not. There is a ton of supply coming to the market. A lot of farmers are doing the cash rent or the cash sales thing. They're selling it right off the combine. They're hauling it into the elevator or co-op or wherever. This is the worst time to make those sales. So for those of our producers that said less than 20% or 20 to 40%, great. My next question, which is not able to be asked really well on Twitter, would be, Of that crop that's not protected yet, what are you doing with the rest of it? Are you storing it? Are you selling it right off of the combine? Do you have marketing decisions put in place to make sure that you can take advantage of post-harvest rallies? So if ever there was a time to have some on-farm storage or to have to pay to commercially store it, this is the year, folks. If you have farmers asking you, this is the year to store grains. Because come January, February, March, into 2022, we're going to see, I think, some pretty significant rallies in the grain markets. But let's talk just here briefly about where we're at right now for harvest, and then talk about why I think that we're going to see these significant rallies come post-harvest. And that's kind of where we'll end things today. I know we're getting close to time. And you guys have probably had a long 2 days, especially if some of you I saw out last night, so I know you're having an even longer day today. But again, I was chatting with some folks last night who said, you know, east of the middle, Bismarck, whatever, east of here, we're seeing producers that are having some pretty good yields. West of here, not so good. But if you look, this just came out the other day by StoneX, and it's basically a pattern of where they think yields are sitting for the nation as a whole, as well as each state individually. So they're saying yield's gonna be about a 176, 178 for the corn side of things. Soybeans maybe a little bit higher, a 51 bushel per acre yields. Those are pretty good numbers. They're not record numbers, but they're pretty good numbers. Basically, what I've been hearing from a lot of farmers is that the corn side of things is not looking as pretty as they thought. Soybeans are looking much better than they thought heading into harvest season this year. So again, we've got a couple shifting dynamics here. We really won't truly know what comes out of the field. USDA is pretty slow to pull the trigger on updating their numbers. Maybe you have some farmers that are conspiracy theorists about what USDA does with their data. I certainly hear a lot of those farmers too. But we probably really won't see what USDA says as far as numbers until January, February, March of next year. So we've kind of got to take this data as it comes. But if you think back here, we just had the quarterly grain stocks report last week. We've seen a WASI report coming out next week. We've got a lot of information that's telling us, even with these pretty good yields, not record yields, even with these pretty good yields, we're still going to be sitting pretty tight when it comes to domestic supplies of especially corn and soybeans. You couple that with, again, thinking back to South America, they're setting themselves up for a dry season. Okay, So globally, we're going to see potentially some tight supplies. So that's how we get to the point where potentially we see some 2012-13 level prices come 2022. We're not going to see that this year. Hopefully farmers aren't selling their crop right off the combine, which we know they certainly are because that's how cash marketers do it. But come next year, we're going to continue to see these high commodity prices. Unless some sort of black swan event happens and blows up the market, which of course we can't predict, we're going to continue to see these strong commodity prices, which push up input costs, push up fertilizer, push up equipment, push up land. So how do we help them make those decisions? How do we help them say, yes, here is a smart place to put those dollars? And some of that, of course, would fall on the accountant and whoever they're working with as well, but a lot of that falls on the banker relationship that they have. So as we wrap things up here, this was basis heading into harvest season this year. We saw phenomenal basis prices, maybe not so much up here in the PNW area, but certainly in the eastern part of the Corn Belt, my part of Iowa, we saw basis sitting at really positive levels, really strong levels, which to me indicates, hey, there's not enough grain to go around. We need that grain heading into harvest. Commercial suppliers are tight on supplies. They're willing to pay a little bit more to entice farmers to pull those grains out of storage. So we saw a really strong basis heading into harvest. We've, of course, weakened off. That's pretty normal. And so where do we sit as far as support levels? And so here's maybe where you guys, if you're jotting down notes, these would be maybe some areas to write down here. So we've already broken through a couple of these key levels of support, unfortunately, but on the corn side of things, we're sitting at first level of support area was around that $5.40 mark. The second one you'll see was around $5.30, and then that last one was $4.95 to $5. So we've actually broken through all three areas of support there. A little scary for producers thinking, hey, has this market completely fizzled out? But we were able to at least bounce off of that, and we've made our way since then higher again. So I think we've seen the harvest low for this year. We saw it put in right there around that $4.95, $5 range. So we think here, we see prices continue to bounce back higher on the corn balance sheet. On the soybean side of things, their basis story heading into harvest wasn't so exciting. Pretty normal for this pre-harvest flutter of excitement for all of those grains hitting the markets. And then on the soybean side of things, we've also seen some pretty similar story when it comes to areas of support and breaking through those or sitting right on them. So on the corn or on the soybean side of things, we're seeing those levels of support. Really, we had a kind of loose one at $13.10. We saw another one at $12.60. And then finally, we saw that $12.35, that bottom level of support there, which we didn't quite break through the other day. We saw it hold strong. Monday, we traded there, we touched that $12.35 mark, and then we headed higher. So still a little early to tell if this is a true reversal, but both in the corn and soybean side of things, we've held pretty strong at those baseline levels of support, telling me the market finds support there. We're going to see that really hold firm here through harvest, and potentially these could have been the two harvest lows posted. So where do we head from here? Of course, post-harvest, we see prices tend to rally again, and I think that's where we're going to be headed here come the next couple of months. On the wheat side of things, we've also seen pretty exciting strength there as well, especially on the spring wheat market. And a large portion of that has been, again, to that underlying weather issue, which I guess for you guys up here, you're pretty used to drought, but we're certainly not down in where I'm from. And so we've seen the US Drought Monitor continue to get worse and worse and worse each week. This one just came out earlier this week, but you'll see a lot of wheat country up here in the Northern Plains, your folks' area, really has been hit hardest with drought. And so that's been pretty bullish for the wheat markets. So we'll see spring wheat continuing on that upward momentum, that upward trend. I think probably Tommy touched on this. He and I were chatting about that last night at the bar after he'd had a few drinks. He was certainly excited about what was to come in both the spring wheat and the Chicago wheat markets, but most importantly, the spring wheat markets. We're also both on the same page when it comes to being bullish for corn and soybeans here post-harvest. So I think, you know, short term, we're going to see a little bit of bearishness. That's the market telling us, hey, a lot of supplies are coming to the market. Post-harvest, we're going to continue to see a lot of strength in the ag sector. The health of rural America is there. Incomes are going to be there. We're seeing people willing to pay $26,000 on an acre per acre on farmland. We're going to continue to see commodities support strength in rural America. But how do you make sure that those producers are able to take advantage of that upcoming strength? So I'll just end it with this. What value do you bring to your customers? I kind of shared this story already, but again, working with many generations, maybe in some instances three, maybe probably not four generations of farmers in one operation, but certainly you could have three different generations that you're working with. What value do you bring to them? And how can you help them make those decisions this year when this year is more important now than ever, when we have a lot of extra money to spend? What do we do with those extra dollars? How do we advise them in times like this, when commodity markets have this unlimited potential, to not make silly marketing decisions and miss out on those upcoming rallies to come? So I'll just leave that with you folks there. I hope you've taken away a couple keys to take back to your folks. Couple just summary points for you here, and then I'll be done. But it's important to be a smart marketer. You can't change the markets. You can't make them do anything. That's just how it is. We've got to accept that fact. I know it's a tough one. You've got to encourage risk management strategies, whether that's trading, whether that's figuring out a way to take risk off the table or protecting that risk if you're leaving it on the table. And you've got to be a valued partner for them. Earn their trust. Encourage diversification. What can you do to be a partner this year more than ever? So I'll end with that. This is just my email, my Twitter handle. If anyone wants to shoot me a note afterwards, I'd be happy to take feedback and questions. I'll also be floating around in the room for a few extra minutes here at the end. But just wanted to say thank you again for allowing me to be a part of your event this year. And I hope all your farmers have a safe and happy harvest. Thank you.
Thank you, Delaney, for being here and sharing all that great information. That was fantastic. Well, that wraps up our 2021 Ag Credit Conference. Thank you so very much for attending, whether you were here in Bismarck or virtually. We certainly appreciate it very, very much. Electronic surveys will be mailed. Please fill those out and send them back. And if you're wearing a name tag, don't leave the building with that name tag. Please recycle your name tag. There's a basket for them at the table just outside the room, so please leave them there. A big thank you to Rick Clayburg and Dorothy Lick and the North Dakota Bankers Association team. How about a round of applause? They sure did a great job. It was my pleasure to be here. I wish you safe travels and hope to see you next year in Fargo. Thank you very much. Go Bison.